Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to New York City for live coverage of the Intel Extreme Masters New York Grand Final. I have a sneaky feeling there's a few more Nanny Wah fans in the audience, but there's definitely a few Life fans out there as well. Sue, how excited are you on a scale of 1 to 11 right now?
Honestly, I think this is one of the most exciting finals we could have hoped for. I'm so excited. Life obviously is extremely confident against Nanoa, but Nanoa has shown just time and time again in this tournament why he's a top foreigner.
Absolutely. Let's just check through the bracket and show you the road to the finals for both Life and Nanny Wah. Life has come through 3-0 against Hero, 3-0 against Curious, whilst Nanny Wah has struggled through with a few maps, dropped 3-1 against San, and 3-2 finally against Hyun after that incredible comeback from 2-0 down. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the grand final. Please welcome to the stage your two players. It is Nanny Wah and Life! Okay, plenty of very excited Swedish people right now, and plenty of excited people around the world. This is the grand final, ladies and gentlemen. Nanny Wah versus Life, and here's your commentary team. Take it away.
Welcome, everybody, to the grand finals of the Intel Extreme Masters here live at Comic-Con. In New York City, I'm of course Apollo with Todd. How are you?
What do you mean? My name is Bat Todd, or Baguette Man, whichever one you prefer.
We are having fun here at Comic-Con, and well, we thought we'd join the festivities dressed up for the finals, because this is going to be an intense one. Nanny Wah going up against StarTel Live. Who would have predicted this finals out of all the awesome players that we had here? It's going to be a good one. Nanny Wah living up to the expectations that he sets himself as the best non-Korean in StarCraft II. He goes head-to-head against StarTel Life right here, right now.
Life has been so impressive in this tournament, but he showed weaknesses in the group stage where he beats Zest 2-1 twice. So he's definitely not unbeatable in the matchup. Later on, though, he corrected that by beating Hero 3-0, one of the very best Zerg versus Protoss, Protoss versus Zerg players in the world. So Nanny Wah, he has a tough road. He has a very tough opponent here in Life in these grand finals.
Well, this is going to be a best of seven. There is no map vetoes. There's no map eliminations. It is simply map order determined by a coin flip to decide who picks first. And we'll find out the map order in a couple of moments' time. But we must remember that Life came into this tournament through the open bracket, decided to play through a very difficult choice to make coming here without even a hope of making it into the main tournament if mistakes were to happen. But he didn't mess up. He made it into the top 16, the main tournament of the Intel Extreme Masters. And oh boy, from advancing from the groups, 3-0 versus Liquid Hero, 3-0 versus Curious. Nanny Wah was a qualifier from the Europe region, going through straight into the top 16, advancing over Hack twice in the group stages. And then in the bracket, 3-1 versus San, 3-2 versus Hyun, an epic semi-final. But here is the map order starting to take shape.
And Life's usual veto is Yeonsu, at least in a best of five, whereas Nanny Wah has been removing Whirlwind every single time as first, I believe. So luckily for him, it has not been picked in the first few maps here. And with Polar Knight, starting on Polar Knight here, I mean, we've seen how hard it can be to beat Zergs on this map. I think Life is going to want to look to start with a 1-0 here, surely. Akinon Waste, I do believe this was Nanny Wah's pick. How do you think about this map?
I think that, Akinon Waste is obviously going to be Nanny Wah's choice here, but I'm looking at Nanny Wah's choices. That would be Akinon Waste, then Whirlwind, then Frost. But Life's chosen Polar Knight. And I think that's a good start to look at this series, because this is where he wants to kick things off, make it difficult for Nanny Wah right from the get-go. And remember, that Life had the opportunity to watch Naniwa Zerg versus Protoss, or should I say Protoss versus Zerg, in the semi-finals. He had the option to see what Hyun did right, what Hyun did wrong, and now can really push himself forward in this grand final.
Life has an insane win rate, actually, in the matchup. I checked on some website earlier, and he wins about 80% of the time versus Protoss in series, at least in maps, more like 75%, but series more important. And he recently beat some very, very strong players, not just in this tournament. He was able to take out Puck earlier on in this tournament, and he beat Zest twice, he beat Hero.
Yeah.
But before that, he was able to beat Area in the WCS Korea, Trust as well, Deer and Trap in the GSTL, so he's definitely a very strong contender to take the finals, in my opinion. Do you agree?
I agree. I think Life comes into this finals as the favorite, but so did Hyun go into the semi-finals against Naniwa as well. Naniwa defying the odds earlier. Can he do it again now in the grand finals? Naniwa's last tournament victory, by the way, over 2 years ago.
Really? That long?
April 2011 was the last major big tournament I think he won. The MLG was the number one premier tournament that he picked up a long, long time ago. On the other hand, though, Life has been more superior not so long ago. Of course, just roughly 6 months ago, was on top of the world, regarded as the best player in the world, winning 5 major tournaments in just a short 6 month time frame. But in 2013, he started off rough. He wasn't quite the same player when he entered Heart of the Swarm, but now he's starting really to get back into shape with a round of 8 at DreamHack Summer, and then going to DreamHack Bucharest, getting top 4, improving every step of the way, and he lands himself here already in the finals.
And Smix was mentioning to me that Life, he seems to always do really well at the tournaments here in the US. Remember, he was the winner of the first tournament on Heart of the Swarm, the MLG, which was played in the US.
Yes.
Which was arguably the first tournament. So always very strong showing from him. Even on Heart of the Swarm, he was one of the very best Wings of Liberty players as well. And I'm really excited here to see exactly how these players go into this match. Nice sign.
Of course. Thank you guys for coming out here today. An amazing audience. There's so many people out there here supporting StarCraft II. So thank you very much for coming here to watch this grand finals. And it is going to be a very good finals. Naniwa, can he claim a tournament victory? Because we remember, before entering this tournament, before qualifying for this tournament, Naniwa played in the World Championship Series in Europe in Season 3, where he made the Season 2 finals right before that. He was in hopes to be one of the foreigners, one of the non-Koreans to make it to BlizzCon. With a disappointing finish in the round of 32 for Naniwa, he found himself in a very difficult place when it came to gaining points.
Yes.
He's in the top 16 currently. He's made it to the finals here. He's gained himself an extra 450 points just by being in the finals. With a victory here, that's another 300 points. If he was to be able to beat Life here, his dreams, his hopes of making it to BlizzCon are increased. There's a chance he can still go.
Yeah, and this is so important. I remember Naniwa really wanting to qualify for the World Finals back 2 seasons ago in the WCS Europe. It came down to the last match that he had to win against Vortex. In the end, he made it. He was really happy, but this time, this is going to be the biggest event of the year, the most important, the conclusion to the entire WCS season. And I just want to get to it. I want to see what they do.
That's,
you know,
right.
Life, there's so many things that he can do here. We saw Hyun play a little bit gimmicky, I guess you could say. He played a lot of the same build orders, but Life is somebody who can really mix it up and who has some exclusive builds to himself. Only him does these builds and make them work.
You've really got a good voice for Batman, by the way. Just thought I'd let you know that. But now let's talk about the stars of these two players. Naniwa's still not in the game yet. He is taking a couple of minutes. But let's talk a little bit about how this final could shape up. We know who they are. We know what they've won. We know who they came for. But stylistically, first of all, Naniwa. Talk to us about Naniwa's style in Protoss versus Zerg that he's been displaying over the last couple of months. Let's talk about that first of all.
In this tournament, he's actually changed his style up a little bit, going for a few Nexus first, followed by Gateway. So he's still a big hater on the Forge opener that we see so many Protoss really like to do in the matchup. But I really like that he mixed it up, because this has to put doubt in Lysa's head. I really think that if Naniwa was opening always the exact same way, at least for the first few minutes, Life would have probably opened the first game with a gas 10, pull 10, which would have really hard countered Naniwa, at least done quite some damage, at least in when it's Life playing against him. Whereas now, if Live tries to go for that and Naniwa does the same build as he did before, he might be quite all right against it. It's really going to come down to the scouting, maybe a little bit of fortune here and there, getting lucky, spotting something. And nobody really wants to take those big risks. When you try to counter someone, a lot of the time, you're going to want to take the safe path about it and be as sure as possible that he's going to do something. But now with Naniwa mixing it up in the tournament, if I was Life, I would probably go into the first game thinking, I'm just going to play standard, test the weather, see where it takes me. He's not really afraid of anybody as far as early game, mid game, and late game goes. Anyway, he can take great decisions on any map and in any situation. And since he's Polar Knight, he doesn't even necessarily have to do anything special. He can just play a standard game and make it work, make sure he can secure himself the first win in this match.
Well, Life has been playing very aggressive in his games this weekend against Protoss players, forcing mistakes, and as soon as he finds an opening, bam, he goes for it, he waypoints his units across, and he will wear you down. If Naniwa wants to win this finals, I mean, apart from the simple thing that I can say of making mistakes, where is the key to success for Naniwa against Life, who is so dangerous, who is so aggressive?
I think the thing about Life is that if he figures out what you're doing early enough, you're almost never going to beat him. You're going to be in so much trouble. So if Naniwa managed to disguise his build orders and his strategies just a little bit, he can maybe fool Life into making a few mistakes here and there, and then he can capitalize on those by just hitting a very few extremely crisp timings that are going to be also hard to make work, even if he tricks his opponent. So I think the secret is just going to be tricking his opponent completely. But Life is a very hard guy to trick. He's always ready for anything. He has some of the very best injects in the world. Very good crisp spread. He reads the game extremely well. He always knows what to prioritize during the game. And that makes him a very, very scary player to play against.
All right, well, we are now seconds away from starting the Grand Finals. Thank you all for coming out here in New York City to experience the best game in the world, StarCraft II, right here, right now. The Grand Finals of the Intel Extreme Masters is seconds away. Both players have said they are ready. Life is ready. Naniwa is ready. We are ready. And it's going to begin any second now. Potential seven maps. Here in the Grand Finals, a best of seven. The first player to get to four wins will be crowned the Intel Extreme Masters New York champion. It is time! Game number one, up here. Spawning in the top as the red Protoss. You're already chanting his name, it's Naniwa! And he must go head to head in this finals against a fierce opponent, a very dangerous and aggressive one playing for StarTail. He goes by the name of Life!
All right, Naniwa has gone for the pylon we've seen him get in almost every single game so far versus Zerg that he's played in this tournament, which was only against Young. He's seemed to favor a lot the Nexus first, but it looks like in this game he's going to go for his standard Gateway 13. So I wouldn't be surprised if he goes into the double gas like he did before and then just from there uses his best build. What he said was his best build order, which he somehow lost with the first two games against Young. It was the double Stargate Void Ray into the quick charge, charge load build. And it just felt like in the first two games, he wasn't executing that well and Hyun countered it perfectly. But later on, he corrected some of those things in the build. He made it better as times went on and he made it work very nicely. Nice hatch block, but Naniwa always scouts for it.
Always scouts for it. And what is his going to be response here? He's seen it nice and early.
He's going to chrono boost. I think two Zealots.
Yep.
Usually you can even pull some probes, but Naniwa does not seem interested in doing just this, so I think he's just going to chrono boost one Zealot for sure, maybe a second one, and get a slow cancel on it, and then from there, he just either goes into a Stargate or a quick Robo. There are a lot of possible responses. Yeah. The thing is, his expanding is going to be delayed quite a bit, especially since he does not seem interested in pulling probes. Oh, he was supply blocked for some time. He threw down the second pylon quite late. You saw now the Zealot was queued and didn't start.
All right, well, let's find out how this is going to unfold here momentarily. as the first Chrono Boost has gone into that gateway, and we will see the Zealot out there. Hatchery has been thrown down here for life, back at home, as well as the spawning pool, of course, will be... I mean, on its... Well, it's already been made here. Is the Zealot going across here? Let's have a look how well Naniwa's going to be able to deal with this. Zealot's going on the Hatchery already.
Yeah, second one underway as well.
Yeah.
What do you think? Stargate? Robo? Okay, the hatch just finished at 352. A queen takes 150 seconds to complete, but now the queen hasn't been started. I'm pretty sure Naniwa is looking at the hatchery right now, waiting to see if a queen starts. If the queen begins and he sees it, he's going to time it really, really well to go there with probes, surround the queen as it comes out, not to let it drop down Cryptomore. This is very important. If life drops down Cryptomore here, I mean, he's going to be so far ahead.
All right, well, let's find out if that's going to be the case here, because the Zealots are already doing a lot of damage to this hatchery. Yeah. The Mothership Core comes in with a bit of extra damage on top of it. And to be honest, that hatchery looks like it's going down here, doesn't it?
With Lifeless Bill here, he got the pull way too late to be able to get a queen on time, so he's not even going to start it, which I like here. Because in the meantime, he's taking a third base, he's going to be going for speed, and just like his opener in general, imagine how long this is going to take to be removed, this creep. It's going to take a long time to disappear. In the meantime, Life is not only taking a third base, he's making sure he cannot die against any kind of one-base aggression by getting speed and having the capability of making Zerglings that are going to be very strong in this situation.
But the Stargate has been made for Naniwa. He's already got an Oracle on the way. There's three Zealots out there which are moving across to the other side of the map. Surely, this third hatchery will not survive here. There's no way to defend it at this point. He's making a couple of Zerglings here. If the Mothership gets over there, and maybe the Oracle as well, if Naniwa was to destroy this hatchery...
I don't think he's going to be able to, actually. If Life from here just gets mass Zerglings, with speed on the way and just a few seconds, well, a little bit less than a minute away from finishing, he should be able to defend this. He's, surprisingly enough, he's not sending queens over there. But I do not think that he's going to be letting this die.
All right, well, let's find out, because the Mothership Core and Oracle's here to back the three Zealots up. The Life Slings moving across here, looking to get us around. The Oracle's going to obviously turn on his Pulsar Beam, and here we do go. The Zealots are going still to town on this hatchery, and it's down to 400 hit points. The Zerglings waiting, and they're just going to give it up. And Naniwa will destroy the third hatchery of Startail Life here.
I'm really surprised Life did not try to defend better than this by sending some queens. And behind this, we had a Phoenix Maid. And if we look at the income right now, actually, Naniwa is quite far ahead on Walkers. He has to be careful with the Sentry at the ramp.
Oh, it looked like Naniwa actually tried to go down there to force fill in between the pylons. He recalled back with the Zealots, but it doesn't look like his Nexus is going to be saved here. And Life delivers a blow over to his opponent there, and it is cancelled. And Naniwa will go back to one base for now.
Yeah, let's look at the Walker count for a second. 27 to 19. What this attack achieved by Naniwa is that he forced units out of his opponent. He's going to do okay against those Zerglings. He's going to defend for now. But next wave, he left the Sentry on his ramp. So he's going to be all right. He's not going to die here. He can just swap in Zealots, make sure he holds. Life's going to try to go for the probe. Oh, he could force field. Oh, okay, that was close.
All right, well, here we are. Going to see Naniwa try to re-expand here momentarily. Has thrown down a couple of gateways and started Phoenix production. But if you were situation, especially because there's 12 more Zerglings on the way. How is Naniwa shaped up? He's got a sentry. He can start to make another wall or a bit extend that wall, should I say.
Yeah, I think if he manages to wall here and gets one more sentry behind his wall, he's going to be quite all right. But Life does not want to let this happen. This is going to be so close. If he can get in with the Zerglings, he's going to keep on trading against the Zealots, get one more cancel on the Nexus possibly, and it's going to be so hard for Naniwa to manage his Phoenixes at the same time.
Yeah, okay, the Zerglings get in there, they surround that Zealot immediately, and now Naniwa is forced in a position where what does he do? How is he going to defend this? He whoops in three more Zealots. Can he hold on? The Phoenix is on the other side. Will pick up a queen. And the Zealots are here to help out. Supply block here for Life at the moment. And 44 supply. Naniwa so far doing all right. Picks off, or will pick off this queen here, I think.
Wow, Naniwa's doing quite all right. Yeah, he's a little bit behind on Walkers, but he's going to kill those two queens. He's going to be able to pick off even more units later on. And he's going to secure his expansion most of all, which I was not sure this was going to be possible at this point.
And Naniwa starting off this game really well. He's lost the Oracle, he's lost some Zealots. But look at that, 43 Zerglings have been picked off already in this game. Another squad comes here, but with four Zealots, more sentries being warped in, this expansion will get established. But it's two base versus two base here.
Yes, and Naniwa, he has those Phoenixes above his opponent's natural. those, they are not just going to be able to pick off things.
Yeah.
They get a perfect scout of anything Life is going to be able to start in this game. So Naniwa can react to anything he sees from there.
And Naniwa can stop any drone that tries to take a third base, can pick it up. Any queen that tries to assist the drone going down can pick it up. And Naniwa finds himself in a very dominant position. A weird start to this series, but a good one here for the Swede.
Yeah, and adding on two extra gateways, he's going to go up to five gateways. He might go for a pressure. That's exactly what he's doing right now. He's moving out with very few units. He wants to force out more units. He could recall if he gets in trouble as well.
And on the third base, he's found the drone. He's picked it up. He's killed it. No drone there. No third hatchery. And Naniwa keeps his opponent back. Eight roaches now are on the way, though. They're going to be critical in the defense here. But there is a time warp available. There's going to be a lot of zealots. There's also phoenixes to back this up. There's only a single spine crawler here. A spore crawler being made. Naniwa finding himself in a very, very good position in game number one.
Yeah, I like that he gets a forge behind this, by the way. He's going to be able to start some upgrades. Since he's committing to aggression now, he cannot get his robo just yet. Nice pickup with all of those drones. Oh my god, those phoenixes, they are like so annoying right now for Life.
Well,
There's not much he can do against them.
Well, Life has seen the units in the middle now, and he sees the pile. And the Twilight Council has been thrown down behind this, as well as a Void Ray starting here. Is Naniwa saying that he doesn't really want to try to break through this, just kind of keep his opponent back on two bases for as long as possible? Maybe find a snipe on that third hatchery.
Yeah.
Now that he's seen it.
Yeah, he's just going to find out about it, but I think it's too risky. He saw that there was roaches. He doesn't know how many there are exactly. And I think he might be afraid of Burrow, which is exactly what Life is doing. So Naniwa, although he hasn't seen everything, he's anticipating everything right now. And the responses of Life have been beautiful so far, although Naniwa, in my opinion, is still quite far ahead.
Well, it looks like Naniwa is going over to his traditional style, getting that Zealot charge out nice and early to help his Zealots take any fights, and also to really be a nuisance for any units that are trying to get toward the Void Rays, which he's also begun here. But Life has found that probe, and he will try to stop it.
Life wants to go into Roach Hydra, but his economy is just so low. He's getting two additional drones right now. He's just barely ahead on the Walker counter, which is never going to be good for Zerg against a Protoss.
Yeah, and these Phoenixes starting to bank up their energy, picking off Roach by Roach. Roach by Roach, and it's going to have a hard time here for Life to do anything, as long as he force feels well here.
Oh, he needs to force feel very quickly here.
Are we going to see anything? Oh, there they do come down. He does trap a couple of those Roaches. More importantly, kind of saving one of the two of the three sentries.
You know what? Those phoenixes have so much energy. No one of these roaches is going to escape.
Yeah, and Naniwa will just go ahead and take that down. But behind this, we do see the Temporal Archives already on the way.
Look at the units lost right now. Life said he was going to win 4-0. This is not the start he was expecting, I think, in this series.
61 Zerglings, 10 Roaches, and 2 Queens been picked off for not a lot for Naniwa, who will establish his third base finally.
And the Templar Archives finishes, Naniwa has a lot of gas. If he goes into Storm from there, if he anticipates the Hydralis transition, he's going to do quite well. He hasn't spotted the Hydralis then.
Well, here he goes to scout right now. Let's have a look what he finds. He finds drones initially, sees the Hydralis, and we do see that Storm starting up, so he knows exactly what he's playing against here. But also, more importantly, he scouts a third base without gases. He knows his opponent is a little bit crippled when it comes to his economy.
Yes, and Life, he knows that there is a very short timing here. He has to hit and make work in order to regain the advantage maybe in this game. So he might try to go for a pre-storm attack. He was hesitating here for a second. He was moving across the map. You can tell right now he's a little bit confused. He's not really being put in this position very often by his opponents.
Well, here comes Life. He's got a lot of units here, a lot of Hydralis. How well is Naniwa going to deal with this?
Storm was cancelled.
Storm was cancelled indeed. Two Archons made instead. Looks like Naniwa didn't want to wait for it and just needed to make sure he could get this third Nexus up. Life's going to come down here. There is a couple of force, fields.
Going to pick up some Hydras.
Yeah, the time warp is there. The Zealots get right in. The three Void Rays backing this up nicely. And Naniwa is going to push this back. The Zealots prevail here. And look at this. Life goes in, but Life leaves just as fast as Naniwa pushes him back. Three Void Rays untouched. Archons underneath them as well. But most importantly, out of all of it, Naniwa keeps the third.
Yeah, he's quite satisfied with that exchange here. The units lost still almost 7,000 for Life, almost 3,000 for Naniwa. So Naniwa, I'm really impressed here by him. In this first game, he's playing so well. He's getting his plus two now. He's pumping out Void Rays from just one target, like SOS. And in the meantime, he's going to want to look to possibly add Storm.
Yeah.
And you know, at first, I didn't like the choice of canceling Storm because I think he could have gotten it anyway. But I see how the fight went, and I completely agree with him on that cancel.
All right, well, double roach attack here. Life looking for a way back into this game. Five roaches to the natural here, more to the third base as well. Small moves like this always allow Life to get back into the game, but Naniwara is going to deal with it on his third base. Kind of fast, didn't lose too many workers there, and is having forced to use the photon overcharge, going to defend his natural as well. But what I think's really scary now is that a lot of gateways are finished up, with a lot of units thrown down here for Naniwara. As we can see, with gut upgrades at plus two, a good army composition already. Does Life have what it takes to hold on to his third at this point?
It's going to be really hard. He's going to need a ton of Swarm Hosts. Right now he's getting the five first. He's preparing a huge defense. Ooh. You see Spine Crawlers and Spore Crawlers on his third base, and he's trying to buy time with those counter attacks, which are actually doing quite well of buying him time, but yeah, not doing any damage just yet.
Yeah, I mean, the third base was evacuated with the pros, but these roaches are causing Naniwara a bit of a headache here.
Oh, maybe you're warping the ramp.
Oh, he does block it for now, but that didn't last too long there as the roaches burst through that straight away. But Naniwara on the other side, it says, screw it, whatever, is going to go for an attack. And well, those force fields, not the best of force fields there for Naniwara, but he has more importantly broken the third. But can he keep on defending with the units he has at home to stop Life? This has really become an equal game. Look at the supplies. Really, really equal here, but a Swarm Host does get picked off there. An army supply in vantage for Naniwara. Time walk down. And but how much have these roaches done back at home?
I mean, he sniped a very important base here where there was two gases here. And now Life has had to transfer drones on the left-hand side, but he doesn't have the gases here just yet. So he's going to be quite lacking gas. Mm. Naniwara defended well enough back at home to say he's ahead right now, I think. And now he's researching Storm. I think if he just has a bunch of Templars, keeps on moving around, make sure he doesn't fight the Locust, he's going to win this game right out. And now he's getting the Robo as well. He needs to make sure he has an Observer with his army. We could be seeing some War Prism drop as well. I think Naniwara is in a great position at this point.
All right, well, let's see if he can keep on to that great position, because Life is a world-class player. He's already displayed it by these small attacks that have got him back into the game. Locust coming on the right-hand side, as well as Roaches. I mean, Locust on the other side, Roaches on that side.
And this guy, Life, he can make magic happen with a few Infestors. We've seen it versus Hero, where he came back from such a deficit. So it's going to be his unit of choice here in this game to maybe try and come back. He's making a few right now.
Well, more Roaches break into the natural here, really causing Naniwara to defend in multiple locations. A cannon will not complete on that natural to help out. Really for more detection than anything. A couple of Void Rays do come back to help. But at the same time, Naniwara needs to really compose himself once he gets rid of all these units.
Yeah, there's no Observer yet. The first one is being made now. You know what Naniwara should do? A Dark Shrine. If you can just defend quite easily with Dark Templars against this.
Right, well, we'll see what choice he makes now, as the Observer will help clean these up. Locusts are coming to the right-hand side, but if we look at the Locust count here, it's up to 13 already, and Life has got a supply lead for the time being.
I think he's trying to get a critical mass of Swarm Hosts to come back in this game, and Life is doing quite a good job of it so far. Naniwara is completely ignoring the left-hand side base, which he should know about it at this point.
No, he definitely saw it earlier on, so he definitely knows that it's there, but as we can see, is Naniwara starting to lose grip of, as you described, a winning position, or at least a leading position for the time?
I do think he's being too passive right now. He should keep moving left and right, attack the left-hand side base while dropping a War Prism in the main. That would be the best way to deal with this. And I know he's actually quite struggled before versus Swarm Hosts in the past. There was the DreamHack Open Stockholm where he lost against a Swedish player that was, well, he lost the map. And I played some very tough games against a Swedish player that was using a lot of Swarm Hosts.
Oh, what a good grab there by Life. And oh, the High Templar. Oh, no, this could be absolutely disastrous. Naniwara throws down as many stones, but he's always lost three of his High Templar. A lot of the Zealots gone. And oh my god, a couple of great Fungals from Life puts him at a massive advantage. Look at that, 186 supply to 134. Naniwara drops, and his army composition isn't right for what Life has built. And throughout all of this, Life has bought himself time through these roaches.
Yeah, the roaches in the main being even more annoying now, forcing a lot of Zealot Warpins there. And this is the worst thing you can do against Swarm Host. Attack into the Locust and either get fungled or abducted or anything. It's always going to go really bad. And Life is going to keep up with those roaches run by. He reacts very quickly. You know, even these Zealots, they could kill those roaches very easily, but Life always reacts very quickly. He could actually just burrow here on the left.
Well, it looks like Naniwara's going to sit back again because he's got another robotics facility. He's going up to Colossus now. He's really changing up his army composition, realizing what he has currently is not good enough. But I really feel and fear for him at this point because, I mean, Life is just playing so well.
Yeah.
He's played so good so far.
Naniwara kills so much. They had about the same supply, but Naniwara had stronger units. He didn't exploit that advantage to keep on moving around and keep on inflicting damage. Now, Life finds himself very comfortable on four bases, he's not losing units anymore, except the ones that he wants to throw away, which is some very cheap roaches.
Uh-oh.
And with this many swarm hosts, it's going to be oh so hard for Naniwa to make this work. He's got one of his robo, actually, on his third base that could get sniped by the locust. Finally, he moves towards the left side of the map. Oh, actually, he goes back to the middle. He has to be careful here. He's going to get fungled.
Uh-oh, life's going to be ready for this. The locusts are already out. And to be honest, I'm not sure if Naniwa can do this. One storm on the right-hand side. Archon's on the left just getting destroyed immediately. Other storms going to be enough? I don't think so, as life is so far ahead. Good storms do come down from Naniwa, but is it enough behind all of it as the fungals come down? The Hydro survive, and life will take game one. Excellent play from life, considering the start of that game.
Yeah, I'm really surprised he was able to pull through this, but if there is anybody that could do this, it was him, and he made it happen here with the swarm host transition. Like I've talked about before, this guy, he's good in early game, mid game, and late game, but he's also very good when he's ahead and when he's behind. He knows how to come back from such games, from such deficits. So he didn't. I mean, the advantage of Naniwa wasn't all that much either. I think he was in a good position, but they still always had the same supply.
Yeah.
The thing is, if Naniwa had played this, he could have played this a lot better. Like I said, he could have kept on moving around, attacked the left-hand side base, which would have been oh so hard for life to defend. Some warp is a harass against swarm hosts is what you want to do as well. You want to do it as much as possible, especially against somebody who's so spread out. The distance between the main and third base, or fourth base, is actually quite long.
So let's talk about the one of the big things in that game, the roach play, that the different attacks to the third, to the natural, to the main. And if that hadn't have happened, I don't think life would have had the time that we saw to really switch things up. What should have Naniwa done to stop this? I mean, how do you deal with roaches attacking in different directions as a Protoss player in this position?
I think just being a little bit more ready for it with some cannons everywhere and the Dark Shrine as well, or just quicker warp-ins at the locations he was being attacked at, would have really helped. I mean, the first run-by of life, remember it. It did nothing. It did absolutely nothing. After the first run-by, once you've held this one easily, you're playing against life. You know there's going to be another one headed your way. But Naniwa was not getting ready for that. That's why he started taking damage later on. And life started buying himself enough time for this to work. So Naniwa should have known after the first run by there was going to be more. Made some cannons, prepared better defenses overall, placed his buildings really well, and he would have been fine. Yep. He would have been able maybe to attack and finish the game before life could come back.
So when it comes to the mentality of Naniwa in game number one, who started off in, we'd say, an advantageous position as described. How does it affect you when you're in an advantageous position and the game slowly is ripped away from you and then given to the other player? How does that affect you, rather than just a straight out loss?
You're going to be really bummed about it for some time and you need to do your best to forget it. The worst case scenario is that you can't get this game out of your head by the start of the next game. And then while you're starting the next game, you're still thinking about the previous game that you just played and your mistakes, and then you're going to be completely unfocused. This is one of the worst things that can happen to a pro gamer. But Naniwa, he was down 0-2 against Hyun. He came back 3-2. If there's anybody who can do it, that's him. Now he needs to refocus. He needs to think about the next map, which is Akilon Waste.
All right, Akilon Waste here, which if we look at the map order, I'm pretty sure Life chose map number one, Naniwa now map number two. Life's won his. Can Naniwa now win his map choice? As we get ready to load in to this next map, starting in just a couple of seconds' time. Do make sure to go over to Twitter. If you're at your computer, on your phones, hashtag IEM. Tell everybody that it's live. I've tweeted, Todd's tweeted, you guys tweet as well. And make sure that everybody is watching this finals right now. Can Naniwa win this tournament and his life? Gonna get back into a tournament victory that's been a while as well. But now we are here in map number two on Akilon Wastes. Up here in the top left-hand side, spawning as the red Protoss player playing for Team Alliance, it's Naniwa! And the player currently leading in this series, playing for Team Startale as the blue Zerg, it's life!
Life does one of the quickest extractor trick I've ever seen, I think. And Naniwa opened with a pylon towards one of his casters in his main. Is this going to be a gateway? I think it's going to be a gateway opener here. So he's reverted back to his gateway style completely. We are not going to be seeing him throw down the Nexus first like he did before versus Yun on this map. This is one of the less good maps to do it on, I think, because of the big ramp at the expansion. And I know Life is actually a fan of the pull 10 quite a lot, so you need to be careful. Against a guy like him, if you get a build order disadvantage, you're almost sure to lose every single time. But now Life is actually opening with a hatchery first on his expansion. Do you think he goes for three hatchery here? Expecting Naniwa not to expect it?
He could do, especially the way that Naniwa's been playing so far in this tournament. But we do see an extractor thrown down here for Life, so it does look like he's going over to that spawning pool.
And by the way...
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I really like that Naniwa always scouts for proxy hatch. Because now if he had not, and if he had made his second pylon in his main and there was a proxy hatch, he would be in the same situation as in the last game, which actually he handled quite well. But you don't really want to get proxy hatch and not be able to defend for a long time.
Well, these two players in this best of seven, if you didn't know, first player to get to four, will be crowned the Intel Extreme Masters Champion. $10,000 goes to the first place winner here, $4,000 to the second place, and 300 WCS points for the difference between the both. Naniwa, of course, wanting that to try to keep his dreams of playing at the global finals at BlizzCon alive in the end of the year.
Okay, Naniwa is doing what I like to call the sand build, where you don't cancel the Zealot and you go for a quick scout with your probe to see if your opponent took a very quick third, and then you can apply pressure to it if you want to. Is actually, I'm not sure if the Zealot, if he didn't cancel by mistake, it's a little bit weird. He's hiding his Zealot right now. There is supposed to be an Overlord headed for this, able to spot the Zealot, but he's hiding it for some time. He has to be, if he's planning some kind of aggression and Life gets speed and Naniwa does not see it coming, he's going to take a lot of damage. He could lose the game right out. Naniwa has not seen anything just yet, except that Life didn't take a quick third on the east side.
All right, well, these two Zerglings chasing down this probe. The probe will run all the way home here. What are we going to see from Life when this Zergling speed nears completion? Because so far from Naniwa, we've seen one gateway into double now. He's chrono boosting the Cybernetics Core, by the way, Todd, inside the main base. Just finished up with it.
Yeah.
And it is coming down quite fast. So we're going to see Naniwa be aggressive here.
Yeah, it's very possible. I'm a little bit surprised he didn't throw down an extra gateway. Maybe he's going to be a forge in his wall here. And he sneaked out a probe, which wasn't spotted by Life. If he starts making some pylons in good positions, he could apply some quite heavy pressure and possibly do very well with this.
All right, well, let's find out here. Another Chrono Boost has gone into that Cybernetics Core inside the main base, rushing out that Warp Gate research. But yeah, we do see an Overlord making its way across there. And for the time being, it's not been spotted, but it will give Life a heads up once he sees this. Zerglings being spread as well, looking for this. The Overlord now will come into the range and has spotted it.
You know, he already has speed, so from there, if he makes a lot of Zerglings, he's going to be able to defend this quite easily. The thing is, Naniwa has a recall, so if he starts warping in a lot of Zealots and gets around it, he can just recall out, and he's going to be happy about this, forcing units out of his opponents. Behind this, getting the target, I quite like this choice, but Life has shown in the past that he's one of the very best Zerg players in the world against a single target opener.
Well, there's four Zealots here. Of course, three Gateways will be ready to warp in three more shortly if he decides to go for it, and as you said, the Mothership Core has enough energy to go home. But how is Life going to deal with this? He's got a lot of Zergs, a pylon right next to the hatchery here. But surely Naniwa can't really do anything here with the amount of units that are being made.
Yeah, I think he's going to have to recall here, otherwise he's going to lose all of his Zealots. He chooses to trade against the Zerglings. He has to be careful. The Queen's going to do quite some damage on the Mothership Core. He left some men behind.
Sad.
Oh, 24 Zerglings on the way. Life, I'm not sure if he panicked or if he was planning a counterattack the whole time. But this is a huge commitment here. He's on 32 drones against 37 probes. I think he might be hoping that Naniwa moves out, not expecting Life to be going for this many units, in which case he could die instantly if he's not careful.
All right, well, so far so good for Naniwa. He's seen the Zerglings on the natural. There is a sentry, but, oh, there it is. The force field down, and now with the Oracle coming out as well, another sentry will be made shortly here, I'd imagine, once he gets on supply blocked, unfortunately.
Wow.
There.
Really cool that Life got his force right on time to be able to defend against the Oracle. This should not do any damage at all if he's careful and sends his Queen right on it.
What do you make of the evolution chain with the plus one attack?
Ooh, the Zealot! The
Zealot!
Oh! Life gets in!
Uh-oh. The sentry not there. And oh god, the Zerglings get into the main base here. Oh dear me, this is a classic mistake from Naniwa here, and oh dear me.
He needs to send some in the natural. He needs to spread out his Zerglings. They're gonna do some damage, but it's always good to do as much as possible, and Naniwa in a world of trouble right now.
Yeah, he's taking a lot of damage here. Photon Overcharge has been activated, and that's a lot of Zerglings. They're gonna kill a good amount of Zerglings, a good amount of Zealots. Of course, that there is, oh, some sentries on the ramp there. Good force field by Naniwa, keeping them from getting to the natural.
What a sick force field. I know he could actually send all of his units to kill those Zerglings, except he needs to leave one Zealot in the world to make sure no more Zerglings get in. And nicely done here by Life. He killed 6 probes in total,
bringing him worse
to 56 drones against 41 probes. He's taking all of his gases at once. He's starting a Hydra his den. And I like his position. And by the way, he does not have a Roach Warren. Life, when he plays against targets, he's going to do those big timings sometimes with only Hydralisk, a lot of Hydralisks, and Zerglings. And those are also deadly if you try and take a third too quickly. And you don't have enough units to defend, so I think that's what he's going to go for here.
And he's got that plus one melee attack on the way here, isn't he? So we actually see a Forge and Twilight Castle being thrown down for Naniwa, who is breaking the rocks towards his third. And there's a lot of Zerglings here. Naniwa's going to have to be careful. He uses one force field on that ramp, but he needs to protect the other side as there's a bunch of units coming in. Naniwa doesn't want to lose these sentries here. They do try to run away, and they do squeeze through that little pylon and gateway wall, but one does go down.
Wow, this is going to be so hard for Naniwa to hold. Life getting his first 5 Hydralisks.
Yeah.
He actually gets the Infestation Pit, so he might not be going into the attack I was expecting out of him here. And I do think that if he had gone for it, it would be almost impossible for Naniwa to hold. So if he chooses to go for that, it's going to be super hard for Naniwa to hold.
Well, Naniwa is trying to get that third up. It is cancelled, and Life continues to slow down his opponent. Another sentry gets picked off. 3 sentries and 6 Zealots.
This guy's a magician, man.
He really is, and there's a reason why people call them Life Zerglings, because they are remarkable. They get so much damage done here. 18, 22 more on the way. Sentries have been lost. Force fields are not there at this point. He needs to replace them.
Yeah, he's going to definitely need a few force fields to make sure he can hold this. He's Naniwa now adding extra gateways before starting his third Nexus. And he's getting the Templar Archives as well. So army-wise, he's at 34 against 52. But if Life breaks these rocks and starts getting in there, it's going to be so hard for Naniwa. Well, he's only getting Zerglings right now. He has the plus one, remember.
Yeah, and he has the double evolution chamber, by the way. He's got the high. I'm pretty sure we see Ultras in this game. But for the time being, can Naniwa survive? Because Life is playing phenomenal so far with the Hydralisk pushing forward here. Ling's breaking the rocks on the right-hand side. Naniwa's under a lot of pressure. As you can see on the minimap, more and more units streaming across here. A lot of high tempo get warped in here. And we're going to see Archons immediately to help defend. The front wall is being broken down, and Life knocking on the front door. Another gateway gets picked off here. The Stargate gonna follow as well.
Oh, the Lynx are gonna get a cancel on the third.
Oh no, Naniwa needs to protect that. One force field comes down, and that's all he has to offer. Zealots just get absolutely destroyed here by the Hydralisk, and the Lynx on the third Nexus, the most important part of all of this, are going to stop Naniwa's third once again, and Life plays excellent. Small moves, but excellent moves every single time.
That was a perfect trade here by Life. Maybe he could have evacuated with his Hydralisk, but I don't think he had speed. And Naniwa adding all the gateways that he added earlier. By the way, Life spots this. This is very important. He could go for a timing, a counterattack at this point, because he's going to fall quite far behind if he does not. Look, 7 gateway in production right now for Naniwa, because he had to remake his wall. By the way, his Archons are going to be stuck in his main, unless he breaks the rocks, which Life is doing for him right now.
Yes, he is. Life behind this. Ultralisk Cavern on the way. Great upgrades, as well as Infestors and a lot of Zerglings here. Life just going to buy as much time as possible. Ling's on the natural here as well, trying to break through. Luckily, that Zealot is there. But how long for? 3 Zealots.
Oh, the Ling's getting again. How does this happen
again?
Every time?
Every single time. And Starter Life finds himself inside the main base. He's going to have a look-see around, and we'll pick off and scout for as much as possible. The Ultralisk Cavern almost ready. He's buying himself time. He knows that these Lings, these Hydras, are nothing but dummies. They're just fake units. He just throws them. He doesn't care about them. The most important part, look at all the money in the top right. And there it is spent. 3 Ultralisks, plus 3 melee, 5 Ultralisks. And there's 6 or 7 Infestors around with Zerglings absolutely everywhere. 6 Queens, which I'm sure is going to be for a lot of energy to transfuse these. And Life is setting up an army to end this game.
Yeah, it's going for Naniwa, it's going to be so hard to win this without Immortals. The thing is, Queens deal really, really well against Void Race. Naniwa, he's going to need to get some good feedbacks on the Queen. But when there are Ultralisks, destroying everything you have in the front, it's going to be really, really hard to be able to reach all of these queens. And also, the queens are always going to outnumber the Templars by quite a lot. So
yeah.
Naniwa, he's going to be playing defensively for the time being, I'm sure.
Well, he's
but
finally...
I don't think life is going to give him the time to do anything.
He sees the Ultralisk and he says, I can't believe this. I absolutely can't believe it. Life is playing around. He's toying with his food. And Naniwa is the food at the moment as we're about to see life move forward. Can the defensive position for the time being help Naniwa out? There's a lot of roaches coming to back this up as well as life waits, eager to take map number two away from Naniwa. Can he defend? He needs Storm. It's a long way away from finishing here.
Yeah, and life wanted to replace those Zerglings with some roaches apparently, so he sacrificed them. Nice feedback on two of those investors I think he got. Life has to be careful here. He's in a great position, but if he attacks in a really, really bad position... Ooh, the Templar!
Yeah, gets a couple of feedbacks. Two queens, one Infester. I mean, well, that's pretty good, I suppose, but the front door has been knocked down. One gateway, an area for this attack to happen. Feedbacks go down onto the Infestors. Naniwa takes the best fight he could possibly take. Is he going to hold the front door? Storm is not ready. Feedbacks are there, and the Void Ray's helping out a lot. But there's a lot of units right behind this. Roaches piling through. Is Naniwa going to hold it? Doesn't look like it. His life. Seconds away from breaking through. Archons doing absolutely everything they can, but look at the supply numbers. 193, a time warp put down, and Naniwa seems to hold just about for now. It's very close indeed. And the Photon Overcharge, Zealots and Templars getting in. Naniwa doing his best as he can. But remember behind this, the amount of money that life has. There's five more Ultras, more Zerglings. And despite Naniwa's fantastic hold for the last 30 seconds, it looks like life will back off, but the follow-up attack is going to be deadly. Even Zerglings making their way to the third.
Breaking news. Zerglings in the third again.
Breaking news. Breaking news.
And
every
single
time.
Did you see those roaches? Perfectly timed to arrive and try and deal with the Archons as much as possible. He's reduced the Archon count to one right now, and life is looking to finish the game.
Yeah, he's looking to finish the game. Naniwa's put up a very good hole. He tries once again. But the problem is right now, with losing probes on the third, he doesn't have a lot of money. And the amount of units streaming across the map, just look in the bottom left, that mini-map. Blue dots just spraying themselves across the map from right to left. And more Ultralisks are here to play as life. 165 supply says, Naniwa, you're doing good. You beat Quantic Hyun in the semifinals. But remember me, I'm a world-class Zerg player and this is my tournament. This is where I win another one. And he's starting off very well with one game in his favor and the second about to go as Naniwa once again drops in supply. 80. 60, Zerglings destroying the probes on the third. And as we can see, there is not much left here for Naniwa as more and more units spray across. GG, life takes two games in a row.
How many times did Zerglings get into the third base or just in general breach the base of Naniwa? I lost count at some point after the 10th time. This was crazy here by life. This kid can make anything work. It feels like every single attack that would not work if it was another player playing, I feel like. He makes it work. He gets through the wall. He perfectly times everything. And it just works out in the end. Naniwa played a great game here, but it's just not enough against somebody like Life. You need to play perfectly or closer to perfectly compared to what he did. This is so impressive to watch this. I really feel like Life right now is in his comfort zone. He's just playing the StarCraft, the same StarCraft he will play in ladder. He's just having fun and everything is going his way.
Everything is going his way. But remember, even though it's looking kind of bleak for Naniwa at this point, so did it versus Hyun.
Yes.
Winning three games in a row versus another worldwide amazing player is very, very difficult. Naniwa did it before. And to be honest, this next map is probably the most important out of every single one so far. If Naniwa loses this and goes down three games to zero, winning four in a row against a player like Life who seems absolutely on point, I'm not even sure that's possible.
That will be very, very hard indeed. I think only Sulky has ever come back from a three-games deficit in a best of seven, not being up a single map. Naniwa here, I really don't know what he can do to beat Life. This is textbook Life versus Protoss here, by the way. Not everybody has had the chance to play against him. Have played against him before in a tournament. And what happens is that when you see what units he has, you can know where he's at economically.
Yeah.
But what happens in this game is you're always fighting against him. He's always fighting. So you think his macro behind this is not going to be great. He's not going to have as much as he usually would because he's busy microing. Wrong. He gets units all the time. He hits perfect inject while microing, splitting his units, attacking, being aggressive all the time. And that makes him very, very hard to play against as Protoss.
All right. Game number three. Let's find out if the Alliance Naniwa can pull this back. He needs to gather every little bit of strength he has. As we are finally here, up to the top left of Belshir Vestige, spawning as the red Protoss player representing Sweden, representing the Alliance, it's Naniwa! And an opponent. Fearless, just absolutely on point. Down here as the blue Zerg playing for Team Startail. It's life.
All right, life. Let's talk history here a little bit. Life, after being up two games versus Hero, he tried for a Mass Zerglings attack on this map as well. After being up 2-0 versus Curious, he tried for a Mass Zerglings attack. Now we're on Belshir Vestige, he's up 2-0. This is a best of seven though. Does he try for a Mass Zergling attack early on? Does he try for a cheese? Naniwa, when playing against Yon, he was down by two games, and his comeback began on this map, on this very map. So I think now, one of the maps he's going to have the best chance to at least win a map or start a comeback on will be Belshir Vestige. And he finally changes it up as well, in this series at least, with the Nexus before the Gateway this time.
Do you think that he was maybe expecting something from Naniwa here, as we've seen previously? Like something crazy from Naniwa, whether it be a Cannon Rush, whether it be Proxy
Gateways
along those lines?
Yeah, possibly. I really like that life from one game to another. He's completely changing it up. He's one of the very few players who can pull this off and be successful. In the previous game, he went for the very greedy build, but this time, well, not very greedy, just hatch first into gas, which can be a little bit dangerous. In this game, he's going to play it safe on this map. He's up by two games. At least for now, he's playing it safe. We're going to see if he tries something later on.
All right, well, Naniwa is a very, very talented individual when it comes to playing StarCraft, and let's see if he can make some magic work here. And this would be the perfect map. Winning this one would put it 2-1. And then the best of seven victory doesn't seem too far away from Naniwa and too far to reach out to. But the probe goes in, sees no gas for the time being, I think.
This is not supposed to happen, actually. You should be a little bit more careful with your probe. Mm. And usually try to leave before the Zerglings can reach it. And now he wanted to confirm if there was a gas, I think, and that's going to cost him his scouting probe. But he does spot the third hatchery before that. Life not wanting to delay his third hatchery to try and trick his opponent.
Naniwa is Kronenbussen into the gateway here, though. Straight away.
He saw two of those Zerglings. Maybe he was thrown off by the timing of those Zerglings. I did not see when the pull was made. Was it made on 13?
No,
I think it was 14.
Yeah.
So it was the most standard timing. I don't know. Maybe Naniwa is not used of it. You know, these days, almost every Zerg hatch first. Mm. And then when they get their Zerglings, they basically clear the proxy pylons. They don't try to be aggressive or anything. So now he saw the two Zerglings and maybe he misread a little bit the situation.
Do you think that these two Zealots could be used aggressively if he was to grab the Mothership Core and go down with a couple of Zealots towards that third?
Yeah, that could be what he's up to as well. But he's starting Warpgate just now. That's quite late to do some aggression, especially if he's not going to be chrono-boosting it. I think he wants to... Oh, wow. He's chrono-boosting the Mothership Core. So
and
maybe,
the Gateway.
Yeah, you're right. He wants to be aggressive with two Zealots, one Stalker, and one Mothership Core. And he's going to be forcing a lot of units out of his opponent. And since he saw a third hatchery, he knows there is no gas and no speed being made. So this could do quite some damage and force a lot of slowlings out of his opponent as well, if he was to move out.
All right, well, let's find out here. He should be looking towards that, I suppose, with the amount of Chronobush he's thrown into that gateway. Though we do have the Stargate and Forge right behind this. Is Naniwa going to go? Yes, he is.
Oh, wow. As he leaves, a Zergling gets in position to possibly get into the main. At least he's headed for the third now. But it's life. Is he going to try and go for the natural...
Well, we'll find out here. There is a probe. Yeah, we'll end it off. But the two Zealots and Stalker do make their way down south. Creep
and he sends the Zergling, which, I mean, this is not the biggest of deal, but this is one of those things that life always does perfectly. If there is a hole somewhere, he's going to find it. And Naniwa reacts very nicely here with the pylon. He's going to have to throw down a cannon as well, possibly. And this aggression, I don't think he's going to do much. There is 10 links on the way. Queen's in position.
Yeah, very fast creep spread as well. Right to his third base. There's two queens, bunch of zerglings, more being made. And let's have a look. Naniwa just going to go in, sees that a lot of units are there. The defense is already set up. And the follow-up's going to have to come from somewhere else here.
Oh, wow. He's manning a lot of gas. The road run finishes. Seven larvas are saved up. Let's see if life goes for drones. All units. He's getting drones right now. Still. Oh, he spots the third base immediately. Does he go for a timing here, I think? Speed just started, so with Zerglings, it wouldn't be successful. But having forced the recall, there's not going to be any photon overcharge up anytime soon.
I mean, well, he still has quite a few Zerglings out there. And there's only a single gateway for the time being, and nothing from the Stargate, so this is possible.
Two Zealots, one Mothership Core, and one Stalker can kill a lot of Zerglings.
All right, well, good nice position from Naniwa, yeah.
Oh, nice surround by life. Here we go again with those Zerglings in the third base, man.
They're like a nightmare. Zerglings on the third base. Some of them running around, trying to get a surround on these Zealots. Not successful so far, but we do have that melee attack being researched once again from life. And by the looks of it, we'll be playing a very similar style to previous. But so far, Naniwa really hasn't taken any damage. He hasn't been slowed down. He's playing this out well.
And by the way, life here, thought he was going to go for the Nexus, and I thought it was the right move, but he pulled back. If he did, it's the right choice. This is something I've learned with him. He's very rarely wrong, if ever.
Every decision he makes is the right one. Void Ray's being started, though, as well as the Twilight Cancel. So we've got plus one attack near finish. Plus two can start once that Twilight Cancel's finished. And, of course, the Zealot Charge being researched.
So the one Phoenix was made first to hunt down some of these Overlords. But there isn't a single one on the map.
Not a single one
so far. The one that there was above the natural already died. And wow, the Zerglings are going to pick up some probes here.
Nice.
Trading Zerglings off probes at this point is quite decent.
I think he may have got like three probes there, and he's dancing between the mineral lines. Just excellent moves here. I mean, he's getting so many probes just back and forth behind the back of the mineral lines.
And life, because of all this aggression, hasn't been droning up quite as well as he usually would. He's less than 10 workers ahead right now, which at the 10th minute is rarely going to be the case. But I guess he just had to start a lot of production facilities, an infestation pit, an evolution chamber. He's getting burrow, he's getting plus one melee attacks, Glaia reconstitution as well, and getting 16 more Zerglings. Life is really addicted to his Zerglings, trying to do damage with them. And Naniwa is learning. He's getting enough defense everywhere to make sure he doesn't take too much damage. You see, he's making pylons behind his middle line. He's got a cannon there. At his natural, he's got units.
And at the same time, two Void Rays have found the fourth base here, a weakness from life, and it does get cancelled. So nice move here from Naniwa, who does take a supply lead. And with the Zealot Charge on the way with plus two attack, things are looking brighter here for Naniwa, who has an advantage when it comes to almost every aspect. The army, the worker supply, the composition he's going towards. But let's talk a little bit about the Zerglings and Infestors here with double upgrades for the Zerglings from life. Not deciding to go towards Hydralis here and focusing very heavily on Infestors.
Yeah, we've seen life make magic happen with his Infestors. He knows he's up against at least a few Void Rays here. He's expecting Charge and Archons behind this with Templars. And I think in this game, it's just the way he's going to try to go up against it. He's getting Queens as well. If he takes to Ultra here and got a lot of Queens, this is actually... Dimaga was one of the first guys to do this to counter Void Race. So now, as much as Naniwa is not getting mass Void Race, remember, he never gets a Robo until very late, which is actually not the case in this game. So this could do well for life if this was to be what he goes for. But he goes for the Nidus. Where is he going to throw this down and why? He's getting Roaches now. He might think that he has enough to break his opponent. The thing is, he has six Infestors with quite some energy already. They came out, they had Pathogen Gland, they are charging up on energy right now. If he goes for Mass Infested Terran on the third base, there's not going to be any AoE. No Storm, no Colossus.
There's nine Queens. 10 Queens roughly once the couple finish here. Currently, Naniwa has not started to research Storm. He's got Archons, he's just now started it. There's the Nidus Worm. Now, Life is obviously planning a large attack here.
Yeah.
How is Naniwa going to be able to defend this, and can he defend it more importantly? Plus two attack is about to finish. That's going to help out a bunch here.
He's gonna
Storm has been chrono boosted out.
I don't think he's going to have Storm on time, but he's going to need some of the best feedbacks he's ever used in his life to Zerglings still
Zerglings actually pulling Naniwa to the third, and that's going to open up a natural hit to take a good position on the high ground. Naniwa does not want to give the high ground away to his opponent. Storm almost on the way. Cannons being made on the natural.
The Army of Life getting quite scary. He's at 172 supply at the 13th minute. We see Festers, Quince, and Rogers.
Storm is so needed at this point. It's been incredible. So he needs to hold on before that can get there. And oh, can he get there in time? The Army supply is so big for Life. He's broken the high ground. The high temples aren't ready. Some feedback. So stop, but he's got him fungled. He's got him locked in. And the infested terrors have been launched over the force fields and whatnot. And here we have the Forge going down. Storm is now ready. But all the energy's been used. He's got nothing.
Wow, one of those Templars has Storm, but not the other ones. And so many units here for Life. He's going to keep on streaming in there. Remember when his Infestors don't have energy anymore, he burrows them, make sure they're safe.
Oh, another fantastic Fungal, a second one right behind that. And Naniwa is facing an attack which may not be stopped here. And oh, look at this, just the Zerg. The Zerg is everywhere, the Swarm is here, a Storm finally comes in. Naniwa dropping fast in supply. Reinforcements from that Nidus network just continuing to push forward. Naniwa's got so much money in the bank. The hatchery's been placed down. Life just says, get out the game at this point. He just wants to end it right here, right now. Naniwa is forced to use his Void Rays versus Queens. Not going to be the best there. More and more units streaming across. Naniwa is being broken. His economy on the natural's been hurt as well. 27 probes have been killed at this point. And Naniwa is struggling. 97 supply. The fight continues on. Archon's breaking forward. Are the reinforcements from Life going to be enough at this point? Zealots getting warped in. Are dealing with some of these units. The last Void Ray's gone down. The two hatcheries remain. One Archon, second Archon blown up. And Naniwa has taken the high ground for now, Todd.
And Life is breaking his opponent down mentally right now with those proxy hatches. I mean, Naniwa is barely holding, but he has to know he's in trouble right now. Life on five bases. He hasn't saturated his new bases. He could do this anytime and be quite safe. And those Infestors, they are recharging on energy. I don't think he lost a single one of them.
But Naniwa is not dead. 61 probes remain behind this. A long, drawn-out fight. The Hydralisk ends down. Look at the supply. We have to credit Naniwa for that defense, which we really didn't think was going to happen.
That was a sick hold. He's on 64 probes against 71 drones, which is not the biggest difference. Maybe Life got a little bit too overconfident. Look at the supply. They are virtually even here. And Life actually taking a base on the top right-hand side. And
Naniwa has actually found a time to get a pylon up on the right-hand side here. If he was to be able to bring down one of these bases, would help him out here. But most importantly, even though a lot of units and probes were killed there for Naniwa, he's recovered nicely. He's still got 64 probes. He's got his army up. He's got Storm now.
Yeah, and he had time to get plus two. There's not many upgrades here for Life.
Well, if we had any sentries here, these roaches would absolutely all be dead. There's so many units for Naniwa.
And Zealots are going to start picking off a base on the right-hand side. They're going to get drones as well. This is a big deal. Naniwa's going to catch up on the Walker count here because of this.
And the Roaches try to get over there, but Naniwa seems like he's going to break this hatch down. Are the Roaches going to get there in time? There's only three of them. They do have plus two attack. Zealots being spread up here. Maybe it wasn't the best idea to spread these Zealots, as it looks like it may be halted.
Unbelievable. When all look lost, Naniwa held, and now look at how many Templars he's got. They're all charging up on energy. I mean, against Infestors, it's going to be hard, but if you look at Life's army and how many Storms there are available...
Remember his upgrades as well. They're plus two melee, not range. Yeah. Hydras and Roaches do not have attack upgrades.
The weather is going to be quite scary here for Life when he engages against this army of Naniwa.
Yeah,
how many Templars? Seven.
It's been a wonderful game here from Naniwa. Absolutely fantastic. Another attack has now been launched for Life. Naniwa a little bit out of position on the right-hand side. And the units are going to take the high ground. A couple of Fungals do launch. Infested Terrans as well. Naniwa comes back to defend. Can he do it like he did before? Immortal Zealots, High Templar, Archons, absolutely everything here. But a good fight from Life. Where are the Storms? There's one with a Time Warp. Getting a lot of damage dealt to these Hydras. Another Storm should be landing. There it is. Naniwa doing damage everywhere. He's got Zealots whooping in on the third. He's got Zealots attacking his opponent's bases. And he is pushing this back for now. Feedback's happening. Zealots going crazy, just running around. And if he was to get to the Nidus Network, there is not going to be a retreat. And Naniwa
there's an observer.
Pushes forward. There's an observer. He can get the Infestors. The Nidus Network is gone. Naniwa's found a way. And he is destroying these units from Life.
And Naniwa finally with the Walker leads.
Finally, the Infestors managed to survive. But Naniwa... just completely resilient in this game, not to give up, despite his opponent taunting him with hatcheries on the other side of the map. That hatchery will fall to a single Zealot, and Naniwa remains in this game once again.
And a single Swarmos. He started Enduring Locust being researched as well. One more Infester. I think Life, he messed up here. He messed up big time. He's getting Carapace level 2 now, but Naniwa already having plus 2. He's going to have some very decent upgrades against the composition of his opponent. And look at the Immortal count. It's getting quite scary. Immortals plus Archons, they're going to do very, very well now. Life sacrificing even more roaches, trying to buy himself a little bit more time. Four more Swarmhosts. Do we see another comeback, another crazy comeback by Life here? This is going to be a lot harder than on Polar Knight, I believe.
Well, remember that the key factor in pulling the comeback was Roach attacks here. And Life is attempting it once more on this right-hand side, but so far has been pushed back. Naniwa does need a fourth base. All of a sudden, High Templar come and get a couple of storms down there, dealing damage to these roaches. And they are being chased down. Roaches going everywhere, though. They're on the natural. But likewise, Naniwa is dealing the same types of damage to Life with Zealots on the left-hand side here. Poro. Such an annoyance here for Naniwa, who's scrambling to get an Observer out.
Wow, and these players are fighting everywhere. Zealots chasing down roaches. You don't get to see this every day. Naniwa sniping yet another base. He's going to be the one on three bases against three bases. He could take his own force.
Infestors on the high ground looking for some Fungals. They get one Fungal here, but Naniwa's broken through with four Zealots. I feed back onto the Infestors. The Infestors are dying because the Zealots coming from the left-hand side here, and Naniwa keeps alive with a lot of Immortals. Storms on the right, storms on the left, storms through the center, and Naniwa looks like he's breaking life, and Naniwa, the most important game, takes it, and whoa, he's happy with that one. And he prevents the 3-0. He prevents the match point for Life. And
how
Naniwa
close was this?
Takes map number 3.
How close. Life was sure he had won here. Throwing down the manor hatcheries, making a little bit less units. No drones. He was sure he had won. Look, he's smiling. He knows. He knows that he messed up here.
He knows that that was, in his eyes, a victory. And splashes water on his face, and now this finals gets even more tense than it already was. Naniwa puts up a fight. Let's just watch Naniwa for a second here. As soon as he finds out he's victory, he's already breathing, he's realizing.
Yeah, and Life smiles. Wow, that was insane here. Another comeback in this series. We've had two crazy comebacks where a player is quite far behind, but somehow manages to make something work in their favor. I have to say, this is one of the highest level Prolos vs. Zerg I've ever seen, I think.
And, I mean, you pointed out something after map number 1 and map number 2, is that the way that Naniwa was playing there and then was not going to be good enough to beat Life. If he continued on the same level, it probably would have been 3-0, probably would have been 4-0, as Life expected it to be. But Naniwa, again, despite being down and bleeding, like against Hyun, has the willpower inside him to change it up, to step it up, change gears, and bring out a performance that warranted that win.
Yeah, best your vestige, man. That's where it all starts every time. And in this series, it's going to be no different. Now, can Naniwa equal the score on Whirlwind, which usually is his map removal? He always removes Whirlwind first. He does not like this map. He's not a big fan of it. Whereas Life, still smiling, kind of. He's going to feel very comfortable on this map, I believe, because he's probably played it a lot of time, and I'm pretty sure it's not one of his map veto.
Is Naniwa going to be able to draw this up? As you said, Whirlwind, a map he's not familiar with, or not really familiar with, but not comfortable with, sorry, is the correct word here. But Life, an incredible player, probably going to step it up himself now, realizing that maybe he was playing around a little bit in that last game. But now, let's find out how this series is going to unfold in this best of 7. Currently 2 to StarTail Life. 1 game to the Alliance Naniwa. Let's continue this epic finals. As down here, spawning as the red Protoss player won that last game, playing for Team Alliance, it's Naniwa! And to the bottom left of Whirlwinds, as the blue Zerg, a wonder kid some say, playing for Team StarTail, it's Life!
Fortunately for Life, he's going to be able to scout his opponent's first position here. Naniwa, we saw him go for the Nexus first before the Gateway in his wall. This build can have some weaknesses, as well as the Gateway Expand is going into. So Life, if he chooses to do some very aggressive build, which so far it does not look like he chose to, he could do some damage or at least set the pace for a game where he would actually be in the lead once again. But so far, it does look like he wants to go for the hat-trick. I mean, four players map, we see this very often.
Yeah.
And Naniwa, interestingly enough, he goes for the gateway first, followed by two Gazes. And I always feel a little bit weird when he goes for that in situations where I thought he was going to go for a Nexus.
I mean, both players are so capable of changing it up here. Whether it be Life going for a crazy 10 gas, 10 pool build, Naniwa going for a cannon rush, proxy 2 gate if he did before. But in this game, it is Hatchery first, and his Life Scouts is just going to be a regular expansion play coming from a gateway.
And Naniwa, having gone for this build where he gets the second pylon down the ramp, he was actually able to see that he was seen. If he had gone for a Forge Expand and the pylon down his ramp, Life would have spotted this, and Naniwa would not know that Life knows, and where he is as well. So that's got to make Naniwa at least a little bit confident about this game and the way it's going to go. He knows, knowing where your opponent is, even if you don't know how the way is open, it's already a good advantage. You're not going to be wasting time scouting around the map.
And just like Hyun prior to this, prior to that Jadong, Life taking three hatcheries, then an extractor, then a spawning pool. A greedy build from Life, a calculated one through the Overlord, spotting out what Naniwa has, and most importantly, not have a scout.
And you know, I mentioned this during Naniwa versus Hyun. I really think that this build order favors Life quite a lot, because the Nexus is going to be so delayed for Naniwa. But somehow, Naniwa was able to win when he did this build order versus Hyun's three hatcheries before.
Well, surprise, surprise, Overlord, it's a Stalker.
And you don't get to see this every day. Life losing an Overlord to a gateway opener like this. Yeah, his very first Overlord.
Gonna slow him down a little bit there, as I don't think he was obviously expecting a Stalker to pop out from that gateway, and he does lose an Overlord. So a nice start there for Naniwa with that. Mothership Core now being chrono boosted out as well. But Speedling, or Zergling Speed, should I say, is on the way here for Life.
Speedling is fine.
Speedling is fine, but look at that. Naniwa deciding to go for a Twilight Council here blindly so far. This only is just now about to scout his opponent.
I think he's anticipated this. He thinks there might be a three hatcheries. Remember, this went very well for him against Hyun when he did it before. Mm-hmm. And now, I mean, he goes for Dark Templars.
Yeah.
How in hell is Life going to scout this?
There's so many good things that can attribute to the Twilight Council here. First of all, the three hatcheries. Second of all, the Overlord. Do you see any form of scouting viable here or possible for Life?
I mean, finding the proxy pylons, or at least looking for them, is his only chance here.
Yes.
If he does his best to keep an eye out on the map, make sure there is no proxy pylons.
But these Zerglings could get in!
Yes, but there is a sentry at the ramp. I don't think he can spot the Dark Shroud. Oh, the sentry is moving down!
Uh-oh. Well, he's gone back.
Okay, she comes back. But
he's gone back.
Six Zerglings.
Six Zerglings here, and
let's see if he spots the Dark Shroud. I don't think he can from there.
All right, he's going to have to force
this
it here.
This is so close.
Oh, one Zergling gets in! Oh!
He needs to make a pylon! Okay,
he didn't spot it. He didn't spot it. He did not spot it.
But and you know what? Life, having seen only one sentry, one Stalker at this point, he might be able to know there is something wrong.
Uh-oh. There is 18 Zerglings on the way.
Yeah, but he's going to wall.
Life thinks he can do this.
He's going to wall. Naniwa's going to be fine. He's going to wall from here. But his probe has been spotted, I think, no?
Yeah, the probe is over there. No, it hasn't been spotted yet. The pylon is on the way. The Dark Shrine's almost finished. Life has decided, no, wait, a Zergling has found the pylon, has found the probe.
Oh.
The Dark Shrine isn't ready. There's going to be a force field by Naniwa on this natural ramp. He does not want to miss that force field. He does not want to miss that force field. And he misses it. And now he has to warp in defensively back at home. A force field on the ramp. But the pylon at the north has been found. The Dark Shrine seconds away, but he also has
defend. 1 second. It finishes. So does he warp Dark Templars across the map? He's not doing it. The pylon is dying across the map.
The pylon is dying on the other side of the map. His warp gates are turned off because he had to warp defensively. And all of a sudden, this has backfired. And Life is at 60 supply to 39. One DT gets warped in, but it is going to be defensive. And already, Life has a heads up. A Spore Call is being made. More are being made. And somehow, some way, this looked great for Naniwa and is now really gone the other direction.
Yeah, and Life is going to try to do as much damage with those Zerglings as he can before losing them. Naniwa's plan failed completely. There are spores up in every single base. Actually, two spores in the third base of Life. Maybe overreacting a little bit here. I would have liked to see a spine with this. And he's just going to be in a great position overall. He can drone as much as he wants for the time being with just minimal units. Knowing that his opponent opened with Dark Templars, he's going to find himself very safe. And the classic follow-up here by Naniwa, doubles target. Remember versus Hyun how this went. He was sniping the Overseers, and the Dark Templars did the work defending against the Roaches while taking a third. But I just think that the lead that Life has in this game is much greater than the situation that Hyun was in against Naniwa.
Absolutely. Just through these small things that have led to greater... Once here, Naniwa's found himself in a very, very difficult situation. He does have a DT and Zealot going up to the north here. If there was a fourth base up there, it would have been nice, but there isn't from this position. And Life is not open to any form of damage for the time being. He's got units everywhere. He's got detection around. He's got units on his third base. Saw the Zealot go over there and gets a force around. Nice. Oh, actually, no, the DT did slip out there.
He has no way to scout these two Stargates.
Yeah.
So if Naniwa gets some Void Race and, say, Life commits too much to something like a Roach attack, or to try and not let Naniwa take a third, this could go very bad for him. The thing is, he's still droning up, he's getting a lot of Zerglings instead of getting Roaches. This guy, he loves his Zerglings. He makes it work every time, and in this game, it's going to be the right choice. He's getting Burrow now as well. I really like the way he's doing this.
Well, Naniwa has now thrown down this third Nexus. Can he stay collected here against Life, who has an advantage? Naniwa must fight well, must find a way back into this game. But the amount of units, Todd, that we're seeing streamed out already, there are 26 Zerglings out. There are roughly 27 already. Roaches, no, sorry, excuse me, 17. My math is bad. 17 Roaches on the way. With more coming, though, can Naniwa hold this position?
I mean, he has Dark Templars that he can warp, and there is no Overseer around. There is one Overseer headed for this, but the Void Race might find it. Life has to be careful here. I don't think he's going to be able to... That's what I was talking about. He's invested in units that are not going to do anything. And upon realizing this, he started droning up again. He's getting pneumatized Carapace. Mm.
So a nice little thing there for Naniwa. His opponent made units he couldn't really capitalize on yet. It does help Naniwa in this position. Those drones could have been faster. The tech could have been harder.
Oh, he's going for a counterattack.
Uh-oh.
He sees that Naniwa was out of position with some units, but he has enough back at home. Naniwa being very careful. He's finally learned how to play and be careful against those counterattacks. It's so funny, these two playing against each other. It's like a dialogue. They go back and forth. They learn about each other as the series goes on, and Life might try and get a snipe on the Nexus here, which I don't think he should be able to get.
All right, he's got to not miss that force field on the ramp. Once again, he does not want to let these units in.
He needs more Void Race here.
He needs a lot of everything right now, because currently he is defending his third Nexus. I think it may survive, but at the same time, Naniwa's on the other side. Oh, it's close. I think it's going to get picked up for the recall, but it's going to be too late, and the Nexus shall fall. And Life delivers a big blow to Naniwa.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to lose a lot of units killing this Nexus. Remember how that went for Hyun. It did not do too well for him. By the way, I love that he has pneumatized Carapace. He could actually maybe get away with this Overseer if he had clicked it away, but Zergling Strength for a run by again.
And they find the sentries just like they always do. Oh, a couple of force fields saves that one.
10 kills, but on that sentry.
Look at the amount of units here, and then the follow-up attack. There are a lot of Hydralis out here, Todd. Naniwa is trying to get back into this game. There was a glimmer of hope with the third base if he was able to defend his natural in third, but it was unsuccessful. He's majorly pylon blocked. There is a Nidus network on the way.
Oh, he's going for the same thing.
Same style, same attack, but this time Naniwa playing from a much bigger deficit.
Yes.
There is not a big high ground to defend in multiple locations from at this point.
And no infestors.
And no infestors. I mean, look at how can he do this? Can he do it? There are
16
so many Hydralis.
Against 6 Void Rays. 6 Queens as well. He could bring the Queens with him. That will make this so much stronger. Where does he throw on the Nidus? At 6 o'clock? Would be a good position, I guess, to start with. But more Void Rays now joining the fray. And 6 o'clock, Nidus.
And by
poor
the,
Life.
And the, but there's a Zergling on the third base as well. There's no robotics facility. There's no way to take it. It's a borrowed Zergling.
Look at his upgrade starting in the production type. No one of these is going to finish on time. Naniwa might have to cancel those. And
he's found it, he's actually going to find it here.
Oh, he's trying to let some units come out, he has to be...
Okay, so no units do come out there. He does clean up the first one, he realizes what's going on now. But is he going to be able to defend against it? Because there is another one to the north here, and Nidus Worm has been planted down.
And Naniwa has to be expecting this right now. He has to know there's going to be more Niduses. He has to know there's a big attack coming. This is a big tell. He got a good bit of information seeing this. If he can buy himself a little bit more time, if he can get charge, if he can get plus two and air attack upgrades, he's going to do all right.
So many units here. Time warp back. Naniwa must fight out in the open. Two Void Rays get Micro back and they will survive. Great Micro from Naniwa, keeping the Void Rays alive. But is it going to be enough? It becomes a numbers game here. Naniwa has a lot of money in the bank. Another Time Warp has been activated and Naniwa must retreat to his natural ramp. The Mothership Core gets picked off a closer. Nidus Worm has been put down. Ooh, Naniwa, you're in for a difficult time. Oh, life, oh, Startail life with a proxy hatchery here. A mana hatchery, as we call it, to take the Mickey out of his opponent. But here comes Naniwa to defend once again. He did it on Belship Vestige. Can it happen here?
Yeah, it's going to be very hard for Naniwa to hold, obviously. I mean, he's got mostly Void Race, almost nothing on the ground. 10 Queens, 15 Hydras, 5 Roaches. Units are going to keep on streaming in. Both players reinforcing very close to the fight. Oh, nice force fields.
Nice force fields here from Naniwa, but he's got 10 Void Rays and currently remains with 10 Void Rays alive. Microing very well. He's got a little amount of units, but they're dealing a lot of damage. The supply is closing up. Remember that at the moment. It's 127 to 149. Life has another mana hatchery down. The Void Rays have been able to keep alive throughout all of this. Great micro from Naniwa, and he stays alive for now, picking off units after units, trading Zealots for units here. One Void Ray gets picked off, but 9 of them still survive. Naniwa's going for it here. It's a lot of Queens, a lot of Hydralis. Is he going to be able to do it? If he continues to reinforce, maybe.
Wow, and that micro on the Void Ray is always pulling those red ones back. Can Naniwa hold again like he did before?
Oh my god! Oh my god! Another cancelled mana hatchery! How the hell? Naniwa with micro, absolutely legendary micro with these Void Rays, keeping them alive. They're all in low health. And now Life finds himself in a terrible position, or a disastrous position.
Yeah.
How can you play so aggressive, so confident, yet not clean up and get the victory? Naniwa holds!
Yeah, I mean, he's not in the best position. I mean, Naniwa, Life is still in the lead, in my opinion. He has a lot of drones spread out across his bases, 71. The thing is, Naniwa's army is too big now. So if he attacks now and Life takes the fight too early, Life is going to ride out there. And I'm actually seeing the perfect move right now for Naniwa. He's moving across the map. He's wanting to finish the game. Good concave set up by Life. Can he hold?
He doesn't want to fight into that. By the way, I actually noticed one thing from Life. He sent a Zergling to the top right. He's like, there's no way you can do this from two bases. No way can you do this.
Yes.
And he's expecting a third somewhere, but it's not. Naniwa is just really preserving his units so well. If you look at the units lost tab, it's remarkable. The units lost tab, Naniwa's hardly lost any resources compared to his opponent. Considering,
wow,
look
yeah,
at that,
double.
Double.
That's insane.
Absolutely remarkable here. Naniwa playing some of the best StarCraft of his career, and that's what it's going to take to beat a player like Startail.
Life is so smart. Getting all of these pores is the best move that you can do at this point. With pure units, he would have no chance here. But not only the spores are going to do a lot of damage on Void Race, they're going to block Zealots from getting inside the army of his opponent. And he needs to set this up very quickly here. He has to be careful.
Oh, the force was come down and Naniwa's going to fight. The beams of light from the Void Rays shine down onto this army and the force fields blanket this. And is Naniwa going to be able to continue to push forward here? The Void Ray count is at 9 at the moment, dealing a lot of damage, but there are a lot of units. Drones coming off the line here from Alive, and it looks like Naniwa, is he going to be able to do this? The army supply is in vantage of Life at this point, but the Void Rays remain alive.
The crowd goes crazy as only Void Race remain for Naniwa here. He's about to have a recall. 100 energy. Does he recall or does he try to escape? Normally, there is not that many Hydras, so he's actually bringing reinforcements and still making this happen.
He's still making this happen off two bases, bear in mind. Just two bases. The Void Ray counts down to 5, and Life continues to hold on for the time being. Another force field. The Zealots get in there, but the sentries are getting picked off here. Can the Void Rays push through? Life has 3 bases. He has 8 more Hydras.
Oh, those force fields. So, the Roaches are blocked behind.
And the Void Rays remain alive, pulling back once again. The Hydras are gone. The Hydralis are gone here.
11 Hydralis come the way in the production tab.
Where are they going to spawn out from? One gets picked off there. Another one does nothing. Another one does nothing. They're just getting picked off one at a time. They're spraying from that hatchery. And Naniwa with his Void Rays. Oh my gosh, I can't believe this. Another Hydralis gets picked off. More reinforcements for Naniwa. And the amount of Hydralis, even though we saw 12 being made, there are only 9 out. They are borrowed, they are running. How is Naniwa doing this?
Naniwa is actually almost out of minerals. I think he's done it with those Void Rays. Life, he does not have any income almost anymore. He only has a few minerals left on his natural. And, oh, actually, counterattack with Roaches. Oh, he's got so many Zealots plus sentries to tank the damage for the Void Rays to do the work here.
He's going to attack up a distance. Spore Crawlers this time. Is Naniwa going to do it? Time Warp comes down. Zealots reinforcing the Void Rays stay alive. 5 Void Rays still alive here. The Hydralis count is what? It's like 1, 2, 3. There's still the Void Rays. He's pulled them back again with 2 red health. Look at them. They are red health.
How is he doing it? He is absolutely pushing forward. More units coming from life, but Naniwa keeps him alive. Are these Void Rays with low health gonna stay in this game? The Zealots continue to keep in here. Naniwa pulls back one more time.
Two Infestors were mid. Without Pathogen Glance, they're gonna use Infested Terrans. Naniwa has a very few units left. He's Void Rays.
One Void Ray gets picked off there. Only two of the remaining five survive. And Life has a counterattack on the other side of the map, by the way, with Roaches. And Naniwa pushing for 40 supply to 84. Has Life held on throughout all of this? There's no income from Naniwa.
These are his last units.
Is he going to be able to do it? All Life will make the most incredible hold. Both players playing fantastic here in the grand finals of the Intact Stream Masters. And is it going to be enough? Three Zealots, three Sentries, two Void Rays versus two Hydralis, two Infested Terrors. The anti-air is minimal. The anti-air is absolutely minimal. Two Queens come down to help out. Are they going to be enough? It looks like Life pushes one Void Ray back. GG. What a game.
Wow.
What a game from Life and Naniwa. I'm speechless.
Me too. I think Life right now is thinking, maybe I should stop messing around with this guy because he can hold, he can micro, and this guy can play some seriously good StarCraft. What a sick hold there by Naniwa, almost making it happen. As I said, after this huge hold, Naniwa had done what he had to do to survive, but he was still behind economically with 51 probes to 70 drones. So he went for the counterattack immediately, which was the perfect move that he had to make. He did not try to go for a third base. He did not waste any time around. He attacked, and he almost made this work. Just a little bit of different micro, and this would have gone a completely different way. Any more mistakes by Life, this was such a hard-fought game, and both players did so many things right. In the end, Life barely making it happen.
In equal terms, if Naniwa had what Life had when it came to production and economy, Naniwa wins that right out. Absolutely phenomenal control of the small amount of units he had. And as you said, Life now must be saying, all right, time to stop all jokes, everything now. Even though he's winning 3-1, Naniwa, absolutely killer games from him. But can Naniwa stay calm and win 3 games in a row, Todd, against a player like that?
And we are playing on Yunsu now, which is usually Life's map removal. So that's going to be interesting. Maybe he feels uncomfortable on the map, although I'm pretty sure he can play very well on any map. He might not be as comfortable on it as on other maps. Can Naniwa exploit that? Does Naniwa have a good plan in his mind? Let's see.
All right. Let's continue. Here in live from New York City at Comic-Con, the grand finals of the Intel Extreme Masters. Down here, spawning as the red Protoss player. What a previous game from him, despite losing it. Playing for Team Alliance, it's Naniwa! And this player likewise playing up to skill, up to par with Naniwa previously. Playing for Team StarTail, it's Life!
Like I said, both players playing really well right now. Naniwa's macro, decisions, vision, everything good, but that Void Ray micro, man, that was ridiculous. It's so hard to do. Pull them back on time, send them back into the fight. They're going to survive, and then the units, the Hydralisks, are going to be attacking other Void Rays. They regenerate shields. This was the only reason he held. Those pullbacks from the Void Rays, perfect time warp and force field. I'm so impressed with the way he was able to make this happen. But Life, too strong again in the previous game. Yeah. And I really like this Nidus strategy, by the way. This is the first time I've seen this happen. A Zerg thinking he's really far ahead and trying to exploit the Nidus the way it should be used. If you think you have an advantage and you're too far to reinforce very quickly, you just throw down the Nidus like this and your units get there instantly. It's basically the warping of Zergs.
I really like here that, but did you see the drone scout? He scouted inside his main base in case there was proxy gateways from Naniwa. But yeah, I mean, I loved also, as you say, the Nidus weren't played great from Life. But now let's, obviously Life is in the driving position. It's 3-1. He needs one more win and he is the Intel Extreme Masters champion. He's got 3 games comfort zone. But now let's look at Naniwa. What do you think that Naniwa would be thinking and how to approach playing on Yongsu against the way that Life is playing?
You know, he's already playing so well, it's just not working out. Remember what he did against Hyun when he thought that Hyun might start hard countering him? Yeah. He went for a completely different thing. So now, in the previous game, he was already trying to surprise his opponent with one of the things that he did against Hyun. It's just that the execution was not good enough with the Dark Templars. He had time to warp in some Dark Templars across the map. He could have not let his opponent get inside of his base with the Zerglings, although against life, it does seem pretty impossible at times. And if this had happened, Naniwa could have outright won the game with those Dark Templars. So in this game, if he goes again with the same strategy he did against Hyun with the Blinkstalkers and it surprises life, he might be able to get a quick win.
All right, well.
Pylon, okay.
Life Zerglings do attempt to get inside the main base here. Pylon is made. Mothership Core will push these back for now. A very tense arena here in Comic-Con as we wait to find out how this match is going to be played out. Fast Stargate from Naniwa before Warpgate research, before anything here.
In his wall, too. And a forge. Okay, so he's going to be getting units out of just one gateway for quite some time. And has to be careful with his wall here. Maybe get a cannon against life, I mean. Maybe get five cannons.
Maybe get
enough
five
is
cannons. Yeah, life circling is absolutely remarkable. Just finding their way through every single little crack.
And life is opening four queens here.
He scouted the Stargate and Forge, by the way, with that Overlord.
This is really cool. I mean, any kind of early on unit is not going to do anything here. He could start killing those rocks to take the top left hand side base. And he's going to be adding one gas in each base, life that is. Do you think he goes for a quick third from there? Why is he getting... This is a Zerg versus Terran build, feels like.
Yeah. He's playing very cautiously here. I mean, taking the third base, if he doesn't take it soon, he's not going to take it any time because the Phoenixes are going to be on top of it. They'll find the drone trying to go down and it will get delayed significantly. You'd have to imagine he'd try to get it very soon.
And I really like that. The creep spread, because of those queens, is going to start very early on. If you can get a very good creep spread going on this map, Swarm Hosts are going to be a great choice, but just Roaches and Hydralisk are going to be made a lot stronger as well. Oh, double evolution chamber by life. Mm. Is this the mass Zergling and melee units style that we've seen before? Or because he might think he's up against targets. He goes into lots of links, queens, and then ultras.
Maybe.
And investors, maybe.
Maybe, yeah. We'll have to find out. He started his lair as well here. Could it be for a heavy Hydralisk play with double upgrades at the same time here? We'll have to find out.
Oh, good point.
Let's wait. Double evolution chambers are finished, though. The most important part of this, which is it? Attacking upgrades? Attack range, sorry? Or melee?
Melee, I think. When you make Evos this early, usually it's for melee. But, oh, you are right. Nice read.
So,
he's going to go for missile.
So, with this coming in, he's going to play a very... It must be very heavy Hydralisk. And imagine, with the creep spread started so early with the queens that he's got, the Hydralisk are going to zip across the map. They'll get to that base third. And if Naniwa isn't set up correctly in time, he could be in trouble. By the way, only one evolution chamber being... Okay, never mind. That has been used now.
They are going to zip across the map?
Zip.
All right.
All right.
Whatever that means. Roach running on the way.
Like a zip line, you know, zip line.
Okay.
They're going to get right across there. So the Phoenix is now, there's quite a few of them, five, but Naniwa yet to identify exactly what he's playing against. He's seen the double evolution chamber, but as you said, you're a Protoss player, you could have thought it was Zergling style.
Yeah.
Naniwa needs to kind of know, but how is he really going to know until it's too late? Roach Warren, is that enough?
I thought they were pretty early, but maybe they were not that early, actually. But Naniwa, I feel like he has overmade Phoenixes. You're supposed to get four or five, now he's made six. This can be a big deal. This is going to delay any kind of later take he needs to get a little bit. And he's getting a cannon at his expansion quite early on in this game. So I think maybe he's had enough of the Zergling run-bys. This is really going to help against it.
Yeah, and well, it looks like Naniwa going to attempt here to just fly around, scout out as much as he can, and he's seen the lair finish. Roach speed is on its way. Naniwa's got an established third base already. Twilight Council is down. Where is the Hydralisk then? Is it
not
just
here.
Roaches? Surely not just
He's getting a lot
roaches.
Of roaches right now, but mixing it up with adding extra drones, maybe Mass Roach Queen had Nidus? Don't you think that's a possibility? Okay, well, infestation pit.
He's already at five queens here, but by the way, Naniwa's found this drone line. Even though there's a spore crawl there, he picks up a couple of drones throughout this. Oh my god, throughout this, he's already killed 13 drones. That's actually pretty big.
Yeah, and Naniwa is actually a pro bleed right now. I like his position in this game. If he adds on a lot of extra gateways here, which is exactly what he's doing.
Yeah, and Temple Archive started fast, very fast. No plus two, no Zealot charge for now. Templar Archives first. Naniwar is telling us that he wants Storm fast in this game, Todd.
Or actually, he wants to have the option to feedback as well. Remember in the previous game when he got attacked by all the Aldralisk and Queens? And it was mostly Queens against Voidress. If he had had a lot of Templars, he didn't have the Templar Archive. Because he was investing a lot into Voidress to try and defend his third. If he had had the Templar Archive and would only warped in Zelotan and Templars, he could have feedbacked all of these Queens, which were quite high on energy for some of them, and then made Archons in support.
Mm. Remember, there's no Zergling speed as well, so it's very heavy. Roach, Queen, Infestor for the time being. There's no Hydralis Den, Roach, Queen, Infestor. 8 gateways in production. That's a lot of bloody gateways in production. Plus 2 attack.
Look at this.
Zealot Charge starting. There are the gateways being added on.
It's like a whole city.
But now we see Enduring Locusts on the way. And that's a big switch up, of course.
Yeah, and Naniwa has shown that he struggles a little bit against these Locusts before, against this Wormhost play. Remember what I mentioned about the Quick Spread? Life is going to have great vision all around the map. And the thing is, Naniwa is not making a robo right now. He has no way to remove the creep. Mm. If Life can see pretty much close to half of his map, half of the map, and he has this many queens to defend against here, and Locust with Swarm Host to be sent across the map, that's going to make him a very, very scary Zerg to play against on this map, don't you think?
I think so. I absolutely think so here. The creep spread is incredible. It's up to the Zelnoga Tower that's on Naniwa's side. One thing, though, Naniwa has not scouted the Infestation Pit, has not seen what his opponent's doing, does not know about Swarm Hosts.
Yeah, he has one sentry with full energy right now, actually. I'm a little bit surprised he's not using this. Although we do remember what he can do with 4 force fields only from his game versus Sion. It would be nice if he went for a scout, at least a little bit more of a scout with his Phoenixes to exactly know what he's up against.
All right, well, Naniwa now finishing up with Zealot Charger. Fungal goes down onto these Phoenixes. The Queens come in here. Naniwa is also moving out at the same time, though, so the Phoenixes will be spared.
Oh, but
now
no detection.
He's seen the Locusts. He's
no
seen
detection.
The Locusts. I mean, he starts the robotics facility immediately, but how is he meant to buy time? He can't just sit back and wait for the Observer, does he? Try to attack in different angles? What does he do here?
I think he doesn't have a choice. He has to wait for Observer. And remember before, when he gave time to Life, what happens? It's never a good thing to do. So I think here, getting an Observer to make sure he can start removing creep or dealing with this Swarmos if Life comes too close would be good. And then getting a Warp Prism to our as the main would be great as well.
But Naniwa, look on the right-hand side, Todd. He's broken away with Zealots.
Yes, that's also a way.
He has the Zelnoga Tower right now. If he can keep his opponent busy on the left-hand side, even though he's losing a couple of units and he is keeping him busy, if they get... Oh, they're on creep! They need to get the hell off creep. You can't sit there on creep. Now they go in. Life, though, is not moving towards it.
Yeah, Life has not seen it yet, and I think this hatchery is going to be sniped here by Naniwa. Nice move.
Nice move, and he's buying himself time and also slowing down his opponent. A second robotics facility, a robotics bay, plus 3 attacks. Storm is on its way. Naniwa needs to sit tight, but he can't even take a fourth base at this moment because there's a borrowed Zergling. An Observer is about to come out, but for the time being, Warp Prism, as you called.
Yes, finally.
He's buying time. He's getting himself up to an army ready. But at the same time, not just sitting back like of other, you know, lesser skilled Protoss players would do, just sit back and wait. He's active. He's killed the fourth. Yeah. He's got the Warp Prism. He's going to be slowing his opponent down. But can he get enough time in this game to get to where he wants?
And this is definitely the right response here by Naniwa. Getting the Warp Prism, he should be dropping 4 Zealots in the main, warping in a lot of additional Zealots while taking 2 Colossi. He's going to be trying to take a fourth and... I mean, he needs to be very active at this point. I think going for Warp Prism speed and making more Warp Prisms 2x2 would be a brilliant decision. Because if you look at the Army of Life, it's not mobile at all. There is a few Infestors, a lot of Swarm Hosts, few Roaches and Queens here and there. It's not going to move around very quickly. And Life anticipates this. He gets Spines in his main.
And he's got Spines in his main, but there are Zealots to the north right now, and he's going to have to run back with Roaches to defend against it. But more importantly, Life has denied Naniwa a fourth base. Naniwa's moving out on the right-hand side. The Roaches will deal with these Zealots, but Naniwa's pulled in very far back to the far north position here while moving forward through the middle of the map. Where is he going exactly here, Naniwa? Where is he going?
He's going away from this Locust. That's where he's going. He does not want to get chased down.
High Templar at the back, getting picked off because they're slow-moving units. But the Warp Prism headed to the main. 3 Spine Crawlers in the main. Not that many.
Ooh, some good Fungals here could lock down this army. Naniwa has to be very careful.
Oh, it's a lot of Zealots inside the main base here. And he's got pressure on this fourth base at the same time. If Life's be out of position, and the Zealots are going to start to break down these Spine Crawlers. More are starting. Transfusers coming in. Roaches coming in to help at the same time. Naniwa still has that Mothership Core to get out. But more importantly, he's got the Colossus on the way.
Oh, nice Fungal.
Vongo from the high ground.
If the Mothership Coil dies, the entire army is trapped. Okay, Naniwa recalls instantly. He's getting Colossi behind this. And he might try and take a fight when he's maxed out here. So if you have many Colossi and Archons to tank, you can win one big fight with reinforcements. And then from there, you just win the game.
How important is it that Naniwa's not on a fourth?
It's very important. I mean, he definitely needs to be taking a force right now, especially since he has the money. Is that even a run by four roaches to Zerging? So I guess when it's life, it's a run by.
Well, he finds the Colossus and they get killed immediately. Remember, there is no Hive, there's no Vipers, which we usually see in this composition. I'm not even sure if there is. Okay, there is a Spy. So he is now building Corruptors. More Spine Crawlers going inside the main base. Life has identified the threat of the Warp Prism. But Naniwa may try a different angle here. He's got five Zealots on the left-hand side going up the left flank.
Yeah.
There's no creep here. The Zelnogger Tower is not controlled either, but he will be spotted eventually when he gets onto that creep. And
wow, some roaches out of position here might get killed. Naniwa goes back a little bit.
Maybe Archon gets picked off there.
Oh, he sends Zealots into the third base here. And that's not going to do anything there. He's Spines in position, but I think he should have been looking to warp in the main. In the meantime, a Corruptor will find the Warp Prism, actually.
Yeah, and this is going to get picked off here. Naniwa needs a fourth now.
Oh, he's going to go for the other one.
Yeah, he's going to take this, and he is getting his upgrades up there. He's got +3 attack, he's got +1 armor, and +2 shields.
Yeah.
Blink now starting.
And the Swarmos are looking to send some Locusts towards this base, because Life saw, actually, one Swarmos chasing down
Naniwa gets a big scout inside the main base, too. He actually sees the Greater Spire on its way.
Yeah, and those Zealots, they are starting to do a lot of damage to the Spine Corners. If he goes for one more, he could kill the Spines and then possibly the Greater Spire.
But the Warp Prism's been picked off now by the Corruptors. Naniwa takes a fourth. 8 Stalkers being warped in. Is this just because he spotted the Greater Spire and realizing the threat? Stalkers clearly aren't that good against Swarm Host here. If he flanks them, blinks on top, maybe, but...
Yeah, you need a few at least, I think. Especially if you have Blink and they have +3 attack upgrades, they can make a lot of things happen. And he knows that against Corruptors and Vipers, they're always going to be helpful as well.
All right, well, Naniwa taking a fourth. We'll get that mining shortly. Still sitting very defensively. And we do see Life pushing forward. A lot of Swarm Hosts, a lot of Corruptors. Greatest Spire almost finished.
Is this going to be a 4-1?
Is this going to be a 4-1? A big question. And we're going to find out the answer very soon. Broodlords, I imagine, can't be morphed yet, though, actually, because he doesn't have any supply. But he is going to try and lose some, I'd imagine.
The Roaches. I guess he could sacrifice them. And Naniwa's army is actually really big and strong here. He could go for a fight, but he would get fungled in this corner.
Uh-oh, he's fungled in the corner. Here come the Locusts. The Colossus doing a lot of damage. The Corruptors are going to have to come to fight. Can Naniwa make this possible? Can he have a good fight? He needs some storms on those Corruptors. He gets a couple. The Locusts blink to the left there, and they bring down the Queens incredibly fast. The Vipers are gone. The Corruptors are dying here. Naniwa takes an absolutely unbelievable fight here, and he kills all the Corruptors. He's getting to the Swarm Host, and the Swarm Host, he can blink forward here and then pick them off. The Observer, I don't know where it is exactly.
Right behind the army, and Naniwa's going to be able to kill all this and counterattack.
Oh, the Swarmos are going to get picked off here, and Life drops in supply. 16, 17 Roaches, 8 Corruptors is the bank of Life that he has so patiently banked up at this point here. He's really got it building, but is it going to be enough? Naniwa's got a very strong army, and we could see Naniwa win another game here against Starftail Life. Very patient, very slow. The Ultralisk Cavern is on its way, but do these units, do these upgrades, don't too much? Yes, they are.
Wow.
What a fight from Naniwa. What a game.
What a game indeed. Oh my god, I can't believe. He played this so well as opposed to the previous time. He was up against the Swarm Host. He got the Warp Prism. He started doing some RS. He slowed down his opponent at least a little bit. Life did defend very well against what Naniwa was doing. But in the end, Naniwa got his Death Ball composition that he was aiming for, which was a lot of Archons and Colossi. Yeah. And Storm to make sure he can kill the first wave of Locusts and then crush the army of his opponent. And Life, I feel like he was a little bit too confident here. Imagine if he had waited behind a lot of Spines and Spores, got the Broodlords, this would have been a lot better for him. He has to be careful. He's really shown confidence in this match, and the two times that he has, it has not gone well for him.
Wow, I'm not even able to string words together sometimes through these fights. The excitement is absolutely unrivaled at this moment. The tension here between these two players as Naniwa gets another victory under his belt. It is now 3 games to Startail Life, who is still on match point, to 2 games to Naniwa. Naniwa going into this next map to win it would equalize the series.
And Life is not smiling anymore, have you noticed? No more.
No more smiles. No more smiles. No more games, Todd. this is serious business. It may have started very easy for StarTail Life, but not anymore. It's not easy. There's a difference of $6,000. There's a difference of having that trophy and watching the opponent take it away from you.
Oh yeah, that's the biggest difference there is.
Having the crowd chant your name, there is a lot of differences between first and second. And we are going to find out within the hour, or maybe a second, who is going to be the champion of the Intel Extreme Masters here in New York, the second stop of the Intel Extreme Masters. We had a Zerg at the first stop in Shanghai, Revival winning that 4-0 against teammate Oz. And here we are at the second stop. And well, Life now just taking a second, cooking a couple of sips of water as we, if you're tuning in, by the way, hello. We are a little bit dressed up here. It is Comic Con, of course, and we're having a lot of fun here. And I mean, let's look from Life's perspective a little bit here, Todd. What do you think that he is thinking? We've talked from Naniwa's perspective. What about Life? What is he thinking? What is he really going to be looking to do coming into this next
map? I mean,
map?
He definitely must have thought at some point, why did I do this? Why did I have to proxy some hatches? It was a stupid thing to do. And then he ended up losing this one game on Bestiary Vestige. I mean, you're not supposed to do this. Now, when you feel you're very far ahead, you might be tempted to do this early on in the series to break your opponent down mentally. Naniwa does not look impressed on this. But, I mean, it was not worth it. It didn't work. Naniwa, he got some wins from there, and now Life is in a situation where there is not much room for mistakes.
No mistakes. The next map is Frost. What are you thinking about this map for both sides, Naniwa and Life?
I wonder how they will open is my first thought, since it's a 4-player map. And we could see crazy things happen here. Life, he has to be thinking, do I go for 3 hatcheries? Do I go for a greedy build? Is there any chance Naniwa might finally open with a forge, which we haven't seen yet, and cannon rush me? Or do I go for the standard play, which means he wouldn't have an as good economy as usually? Whereas Naniwa, he's opened many times differently. Yeah. He also has to think about what Life might open like and try to counter that.
All right, well, as you know, when the series gets long, best of 5, best of 7, we go game after game after game, the players are allowed to take a couple of minutes break to gather their thoughts, think over the strategies and the openers that we just discussed, and we will honor that and give them those minutes. Guys, we are going to go to a commercial break. When we return, so will the grand finals.
This is it. That mighty thing. That thinks, blinks, and winks. You can dress it up, you can dress it down. You can even bedazzle it and make it loud. It comes in black, it comes in white. It comes in orange. Oh, what a sight. You can spin it and make it dance. Anything is possible when given the chance. It can say everything about you, or very little at all. It can fit in your pocket, on a desk, or on a wall. And it comes in sizes from big to small. From tablets to smartphones to all-in-ones. It can be used for work, for fun, and even both with the 2-in-1. But there's something meaningful beyond the bling that makes them run and do their thing. It's quite a special hard-to-see part. The brain, the brawn, and the beating heart. And if you manage to set the rest aside, you'll come to realize the most important part is inside.
Professional grade communication tool. The choice of professional teams. Perfect stream viewing experience. Chosen by online streamers. Easy to use voice messenger service. chosen by over 12 million gamers.
Communication is always vital when competing in tournaments. Winning a map fight coordination, you cannot win by yourself.
Raid Call. Communication for winners.
This epic series here, Todd, and well, this is going to be a good one. Frost is going to be the next map here, and we're going to jump into it right away as both players are ready. Do you think Naniwa can go in and win this next game?
I definitely think he can. After winning two games, I did not expect this. I really thought that Life was going to sweep. Naniwa was maybe going to get lucky one game here and there, but Life has shown weakness, and Naniwa did not let it go unpunished.
All right, well, it looks like both players are now ready. We will be loading into this game right away here as this finals, this epic finals, it really has been one of the best we've seen so far in StarCraft II. As it continues on, the Alliance Naniwa goes into Frost LE. One game behind, three games to StarTail Life, two to the Alliance Naniwa. And here we go. All right, we're it to the next map of this best of seven series. And of course, down here, spawning as the red Protoss player, playing for Team Alliance, it's Naniwa. And to the top left, as the blue Zerg player playing for Team StarTail just needs one game to win it all. It's Life.
Did you see Naniwa stare out there?
Yes.
That was Life. I would be scared now. And luckily for him, Life is going to be scouting the right way first. Once again, he's doing very good with those scouting counterclockwise here. Remember the trend in WCS Europe? Everybody was counting clockwise, and Caridaris was saying that if you started counting counterclockwise, you would do better.
You would find them. It's that simple.
And oh, it looks like a hatch first here by Life. We talked about this.
Yep.
We talked about the possibility of him going for this because of the four players map. I like that with his second overlord, he sent it where he sent it because he would spot a probe headed down there. Almost every single time.
Can he go three hatcheries from this and if he doesn't throw the spawning pool down on time? Will he get there in time to to reactionary do this?
You know, on this map, taking a third base is actually going to be a little bit further away than on other maps, and I think he's going to go for it. And
wow.
He's taking his third base very close to Naniwa here. That could play a very important role in this game here. If Naniwa chooses to go for some kind of different push with lots of gateways, I mean, force fielding around, still going to be difficult, but Naniwa is definitely one of those guys who can use force fields plus time warp very, very well. If there is a weakness in your build, if you take a close expansion to him, you're exposing yourself to maybe be vulnerable to some timing. So Life is going to have to keep that in mind and be careful.
Well, Life spotted his opponent's gateway and then just retreated without revealing his overlord and decided to keep the hatchery there. Could have cancelled it and moved it to the north if he was afraid about this hatchery.
Yeah. And he has to be happy. He has to be happy about seeing the gateway there. I mean, when you go for this build, I've talked about this before, I really feel like you gain a good economic lead. And he also, I mean, he even took the extractor before making the pull again.
All right, well, the Nexus is going to plant itself now on this natural Q Can Naniwa make the comeback here against Life to equalize his series? It's been spotted by Life's Overlord. Naniwa still without any information on where his opponent is.
All right. We've just seen Swarm Host play. This is a four-player map, but they are close position. Oh. Does Life again try to go for Swarm Host, and does he get enough time to reach it? Because Naniwa is going for a Twilight Council, and I think we might see some Dark Templars once again. This map is similar to... Let's just say the back of your base is similar to Hohana in the sense that if you get some buildings behind your mineral line, they're going to be almost unreachable from an overlord.
Yeah, and as you can see in these positions, there's only one overlord, which is on the natural, and it's not going to get there in time.
And you see, he's getting a stalker, which is rallied in the corner where an overlord could fly in right now.
Yeah, because he doesn't know where his opponent is. So, but he should see the overlord very shortly here. Very shortly. It's going to get a bit of a boost head start here. He should still be able to keep this away.
Oh,
but let's have a look. The Stalker's very far. The Overlord is going to be revealed very, very soon. Naniwa has to get over there very, very fast. He sees it. He has to stop this Overlord from spotting this. The Stalker moves. He has to stop the Overlord. And Life may get a massive head. Does he turn it around? No, does he not? And he spots the Dark Shrine, a massive scout here from Startale Life.
Yeah, and Zerglings are going to see that there's two extra gateways being made at the ramp as well. I think Life from there, he just gets Spore. One Spore in every single base, maybe not even in his main. Just gets a couple Zergling, make sure he's safe against these Dark Templars. And then, you know, he might be able to expect the two Stargate follow-up that Naniwa has been going for almost every single time when he's gone Dark Templar. Actually, every single time, which was twice. Once against Hyun, once against Life. Does Naniwa cancel the Dark Shrine? I don't think so, but he could.
All right, well, the probe is at the north. It's a very obvious position to be.
Oh, he's going to find
it. Sorry, but the probe is going to die.
Without proxying anything
is
before.
Gone. There is no pylon. There is nowhere to reinforce this from. Three Spore Crawlers are there. Naniwa has seen the Spore Crawlers being put down. He decides to just take a third.
Yeah, he has to make something special happen from there. Life, great scouts, and yeah, I think he's going to be in a great position from there. Naniwa did not cancel the Dark Shrine, which... I think he's okay, because he's not that expensive anymore.
And he can use it defensively to make sure he takes his third base without any problems as well, I imagine.
Okay, let's see if Life tries to be aggressive against this third base. Well, I guess he already has a bunch of Zerglings there, which is surely going to help. He's actually going to force a cancel, I think.
Is he?
Oh, wow, the one Dark Templar.
Dark Templar are going to push this back. So Naniwa does keep this all-important third
20
base.
20 Zerglings.
22 Zerglings. Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. This is going to be interesting because this, I think, is going to be very difficult to hold here. Naniwa, how does he hold it? Does he warp in two more DTs? Is three DTs against all this going to be enough? Look at this. Micro from Life. He's running around, not taking hits.
The Nexus is 25 seconds from finishing. The Photon Overcharge will help a lot against this. But remember, the Nexus already took some damage. He's not going to come out with full hit points here.
All right, so it's just one shot to hit a Zergling. There's a lot of them that's like 20, 30 odd swipes that he has to maintain here. The Photon Overcharge is going to be nice. It's going to help out a lot. But Naniwa has to warp in more units. He's warping in three Zealots and he is going to hold it for now. But Life's going to gun ho for it. Photon Overcharge activated and Life does back off. And Naniwa, even though very tense,
nice hold. And he goes for the double Stargate behind his trademark when he opens with Dark Templars.
18 more links, you're joking me. Oh, he's got 18 more links on the way.
And if Naniwa starts walling this Nexus off and also chrono boosting it to regenerate the shield faster, he's going to hold quite comfortably.
Oh my god, 26. Life's going for it. Life's going for it. Oh, the wall is open, but there is a Zealot kind of doing a dance. I don't know what it's doing, but there is a sentry there, and it is in hold position. It's a lot of units. Naniwa must keep this defense up.
Make a pylon behind. He's going to force field.
Okay, but there's a lot more where this is coming from. There's a lot of Zerglings being put down. DTs have to be defending here. They need to be walked in massive numbers. More Zealots coming in. And is this going to be possible? Is Naniwa going to hold this on? There's so much investment to units here that Life was thrown into this. There's an Overseer coming in. Uh-oh, Dark Templar's gone. The Nexus is at 600 hit points, 500, 400, and it's falling fast. It's going to fall here. And Naniwa is going to lose this third Nexus, and Life puts himself in a good lead. But remember, a lot of sacrificial drones were made in this game, or not made, should I say, because of all these units. But 12 Hydralis on the way here. Naniwa's army, Naniwa's forces, and production is just a Sentry Stalker and two Void Rays.
Oh, he's going to break in.
Where are you going? Oh, he's got no force shield. He's got nothing. The sentry's gone. The Zerglings break their way through in. And we could be seeing Naniwa defeated here. His life is broken in here. Naniwa's going to do absolutely everything he can to hold on at this point. He does for now, and he has walled off once again.
I mean, if he held with the crazy holds he had in the previous games, he's definitely not going to lose to a few Zerglings.
But
behind
Hydras.
This, Life has anticipated the double target transition, which Taniwa goes for every single time. He's about to attack. Groove Spines will finish momentarily. There are so many Hydralisks. This time, the Void Race will be clearly outnumbered. 15 Hydralisks, 2 Void Race, 2 more on the way, and it's going to be so hard for anyone to hold.
Is StarTail Life going to add another trophy to the 5 that he already has under his belt through his experience? He's 16 years old. Is he going to grab another one here, or will Naniwa continue to hold on? There's an Overseer behind the Hydralisk about to be morphed in. The Mothership Core is gone. The DTs are the last real units that Naniwa has. GG! StarTail Life is the Intel Extreme Masters New York City at Comic-Con champion. 4-2. Naniwa so close, but so far another final for Naniwa, but it is the StarTail player 6 months without a tournament victory after the MLG Winter Championship on the release of Heart of the Swarm. 6 months later, he gets another one. And there, he's found his trophy. And StarTail Life is the Intel Extreme Masters New York champion. A long run he's had at this tournament, Todd, going through the open bracket, came through the open bracket, and just a remarkable performance. Let's hear some words from the winner himself.
질문 하나만 물어볼게요. 오픈에서 시작해서 여기까지 왔어요. 송현도 선수 3-0으로 이기고 그 다음에 팀원을 또 이기고 또 결승에서 이겼어요. 그냥 무슨 뭘 느끼고 있는지 좀 설명해 주세요.
일단 16강이 제일 고비였고요. 너무 결승에서 방심을 해서 자꾸 질 수 없는 걸 줘서 솔직히 조금 힘들까 했는데 이제 운이 조금 따랐던 것 같아요.
Yeah, I believe that the round of 16 was actually the hardest part of this tournament, and actually in the finals there were a few moments where I kind of lost focus a few times, as you may or may not have noticed, but I believe luck was on my side and that's why I was able to win. Ladies and gentlemen, your champion, Life!
Hold it up, I know. There we go, our champion has been crowned for the Intel Extreme Masters New York City. Thank you so much for everyone hanging around. You've been a great crowd this week. We've also got Mr. George Wu. Oh my goodness, Captain America. $10,000 for the champion. Ladies and gentlemen, your Intel Extreme Masters champion for New York City is StarTail Life! And we have one other announcement as well, the MVP for New York City, the Sick Nerd Baller. Ladies and gentlemen, MVP, bring yourself out. Wait for it, it's gonna be good. Wait for it. Okay. Yeah, that's right, the MVP, thanks to BenQ, is Quantic Hyun. Well done to both Hyun, to Naniwa for a fantastic runner-up position as well. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Naniwa. And last but not least, our thanks to our wonderful sponsors who all make this happen. Intel, Raycool, BenQ, and HyperX. Thank you so much for your genuine support. We love the fact that you support not only esports, but StarCraft 2 as well. Ladies and gentlemen, Life is your champion. Sue, it's time to close the show. Ladies and gentlemen, Sue.
I threw a wish in the well. Don't ask me, I'll never tell. I pressed my match as it fell, and now you're in my way. I trained my soul for a win. Pennies and dimes for GM. I wasn't looking for this, but now you're in my way. Your leg was holding up the match screen loading. DBT was going. Where you think you're going, baby? Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy. Try to chase me, but here are Zerglings. So GG maybe. Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy. But here are Zerglings. So GG maybe, and all the time with the wall. I took your time with the fall. I could nothing. But now you're in my way. I beg and borrow and steal. Louder points and it's real. I didn't think I could feel it, but you're in my way. Your lag was holding up the match screen loading. VPT was going. Where you think you're going, baby? Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy. And all the STVs trying to chase me, but more like show up. So GG maybe. Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy. So GG maybe. And all the STVs trying to chase me, but more like show up. So GG maybe. Before you came into my life, I missed you so bad. I missed you so bad. I missed you so, so bad. Before you came into my life, I missed you so bad. I missed you so bad. I missed you so, so bad.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the Intel Extreme Masters, New York City, hopefully. We'll see you next year!